Meeting to order now, and please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the United States of America and to the Republic
for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And with roll call, we only have our student trustee, Raja Sarah, not here with us. She's on Zoom. So we have the full board here.
Ellen
is not here. I thought I saw her. She's on her way. Okay. We have trustee Stoddard still on the way. Next up, we have items to be taken out of order. And we do have one item we're doing today before closed session, and that is 2.6, which is the Commercial Fishermen of Santa Barbara Storage Request Proposal. So we have some presenters here that we'll hear from, and we'll have a discussion. And we hope to get this done in about 30 minutes so that we can get our closed session done, but take as long as we also need to have a discussion. So if you guys are ready, we can get you going.
Well, I'm so grateful for the opportunity to be here to present to you, and I'm so grateful for Trustee Gallardo for giving me this opportunity, and to Superintendent Murillo, it's good to meet you, and thank you so much to your staff, Brian, for being so responsive and so immediately responsive and helpful. So it's a good sign, and I'm really grateful. So I don't want to take up too much time, but I'm going to just give you an introduction to Commercial Fishermen of Santa Barbara and a little bit about our local fisheries, and then talk about what it would look like to put in a small boatyard at lot 3 and talk about the pathway to achieving this. A little bit about me. I'm a marine scientist affiliated with UCSB for many years. I got sucked into working with our local fishing community over this issue, which was actually 17 years ago now. And we've been working on this ever since. And I was so inspired by it, I ended up going full time into fisheries. So Commercial Fishermen of Santa Barbara is a 501c3 nonprofit founded in 1971, and it represents all fisheries in our port. We've got a mission to participate in fisheries management and policy and research, and also to educate the public about our local sustainable seafood. And we run the Saturday Fisherman's Market down at the harbor, so please visit us every Saturday morning. And we manage a shared storage yard at 132 Garden Street. And this was set up in 1990 with Coastal Conservancy funds. It was meant to be a stopgap measure. It's quite small. It's on a month-to-month lease. But we've never found anything more to expand our boatyard. So we've been working on it ever since. So just a little bit about our fisheries for folks who aren't familiar. We've got such a diversity of catch here. It's truly a breadbasket out in the Santa Barbara Channel, and that diversity is a source of resilience for our fisheries. Lobster, sea urchin, crab are some of our top items, but also sablefish, halibut, rockfish, so many different types. I also want to show you kind of the faces of some of our friends and neighbors who are in the fishing community. These folks are often part-timers, some are full-time, but they sometimes have other jobs in real estate, construction, education, you name it, because our fisheries are very dynamic and seasonal, but it makes for a great lifestyle if you can do it. We only bring in about 4 million pounds a year, and that's because we have all small boats that focus on quality over quantity. And as a result, our little port was ranked number one in the state of California in 2020 for fisheries value. So a lot of people are really surprised when they hear that, but our port is thriving, and it's a workhorse for the state, for our food security. We have about 200 boats in our harbor, and that's about double what you'll find at any other nearby harbors. And these support about 500 or more good local jobs. And adds about $40 million or more to the local economy. And of course, fisheries are very synergistic with tourism by supplying seafood to our restaurants and providing a vibrant working waterfront to visit. And of course, ocean stewardship. Our small boats are trained in oil spill response and collaborate with the Park Service, et cetera, and food security. So it's a great thing, and you should all be proud to eat a lot of local sustainable seafood here. But we do have some very key hurdles, and I think they're ones that the City College can really engage on and both provide great benefit and also receive benefit. So number one, we don't have enough shoreside storage, as I've mentioned. So we're focused on expanding our boat and gear yard. And we're interested in trying out creating community cold storage, which would be also useful for ag community. It's hugely needed. And bring back workshop and welding facilities, which have mostly been run out of town by high prices and gentrification, the funk zone converting to wineries. And the second issue is that we don't have enough workforce development. So fisheries, like a lot of, like forestry, is a graying industry. Every year, the average age of fishers gets older and older because we don't have enough new entrants. And this ties back into the need for infrastructure. So younger fishermen in our port don't have the capital to buy a piece of land to store their boats and gear at home. And so without this local storage ability, they're going to other ports or doing other things. And another major thing that we really want to tackle is that there's very low diversity in fisheries as an industry. So we want to increase gender diversity, increase racial diversity, and we're excited about a training program we've already put together to launch this summer that would create an inclusive space with mentoring and networking to increase the number and diversity of voices in fisheries. And of course, training local chefs and using local species is important for demand. And the culinary school has great resources to do that. And supporting the blue economy of the future in general. So we've got sustainable mariculture coming to our waters very soon. We've got renewable energy. We've got carbon capture projects going on. And you name it, the ocean in our backyard is phenomenal for R&D. It's protected by the islands. It's very productive. And so we see the future for the blue economy here, but we aren't going to get there unless we build the infrastructure. And these folks have some training and we've got a pipeline. So to solve these problems, we've put together a concept we call the Maritime Collective Project. And it's a vision that can be encapsulated by putting together the resources, a multifaceted resource center that will meet the needs of Santa Barbara's commercial fisheries and blue economy entrepreneurs through training and infrastructure to help achieve a climate resilient coastal economy. And every public official we present this to loves the idea, has been very supportive. We've enlisted the City of Santa Barbara as our formal partner on making this happen. I won't go into all those details now, but we just are very hopeful that City College will take the first step to explore a partnership on this with us and, you know, see where it leads. We don't know, but it starts with sort of some creative problem solving around parking lot 3, and we can go from there. So I am happy to take questions. I have a few slides on what this might look like, how we might fund it, so I can go into that unless there are any other questions now.
Let's just go into the slides and then we'll,
So funding, right now in hand, we have $30,000 left from a USDA planning grant for the Maritime Collective that we could put towards this, and matching funds from the City of Santa Barbara of $50,000 that have not yet been spent that were allocated for the Maritime Collective project. I also am waiting on a grant for the fisheries training program to start next summer that would come from the Coastal Commission. And I'm feeling optimistic about that. In spring 2023, we'd like to put in a Coastal Conservancy grant. They are the ones who funded our boatyard last time. And we've already talked to them and they loved this idea. They loved that City College would get some benefits out of this and that there's a training component included. And so I think that actually will be fairly straightforward to do. And then also the local food promotion program implementation grant would be $500,000, and that's specifically for training and education around seafood and food production. So next step would be to investigate a planning process. And these are just some of the categories that we've come up with that we would look into with your staff, architectural plans, safety evaluation, risk assessment, permitting pathways. We've heard with your LRDP that maybe the permitting could be quite simple, and do community engagement, a compensation plan, a draft lease agreement, and so forth. And this is just a very rough mock-up of, you know, the idea of having boats there along shoreline. But you can see what our boats look like from our old boatyard. And just to be clear, we want to keep that old boatyard and add this one because we have more demand than could be accounted for by these two boatyards. So this is what I thought a Coastal Conservancy ask might look like. We've got the back corner carved out for boats and storage. And then the red stripes is perhaps some coastal cliff rehabilitation, putting in some trees, beautifying the parking lot. There could be a maintenance fund. There could be a program to improve the composting that I know has been going on in this lot. Relocate that. The Coastal Conservancy seems very open to what types of budget items we can put into this. And again, we will lead the process, but work with you and as much as you'd like to participate in that. And I think I'll end there with just, you know, my contact information. Please reach out to me. I'm really excited about this potential and I'm happy to take your questions. Thanks.
Great. Thank you for the presentation. We'll do questions, not discussion. Then we'll go to public comment and then we can go to discussion. So questions.
I have a question.
Trustee Gallimore.
So I read in the report that with that particular location, it could sustain the entry and exit of large vehicles. Has there been a consideration of safety issues, being that students use that parking lot? And then during sports season, I'm sure that parking lot is filled with pedestrian vehicles. Would that be a safety risk with these larger vehicles, should that become a storage area?
Yeah, thank you so much for your question. The vehicles are just pickup trucks. They're not any large trucks larger than that. These are small boat trailers. And so they have a pretty low profile, but for sure, the boat going through, we would put cones up, we would have a system, we would do a safety analysis of how to make sure the traffic flow is optimal. That would be part of the planning process. And that's obviously a concern. A lot of the activity occurs very early in the morning. And so hopefully there wouldn't be a lot of overlap.
Okay.
Any other questions? All right, we have one public comment on this, so we'll take that. But thank you, Kim. This is really excellent presentation, and we'll get back to you.
Okay, great.
We have Michael Nelson here for public comment on this item.
Thank you, Chairman Abood, members of the Board of Trustees, Superintendent Murillo. I'm really proud to be here today. I'm a member of the Santa Barbara Harbor Commission, and I'm chairman of the Commercial Fisheries Subcommittee. And I briefly want to give you some context and some political history of what we're trying to accomplish here today. First and foremost, back in 2018, the end of 2018, the City Council realized that zoning that they had established to support coastal dependent uses around the funk zone, it wasn't working. They also realized that they had ignored, or the city had ignored and its partners had ignored, the desperate need for basic infrastructure for our commercial fleet. So with those two things, they decided to ask the Harbor Commission to address these two problems that they had identified. That occurred, and then during the pandemic, we went back to them for direction. And at that time, we took the commercial fishermen of Santa Barbara with us to give a sort of a state of the industry, if you will, while we were there. And as part of the presentation that CFSB made, they said that they would take do the heavy lift, if you will, and try to identify the funding and establish the partnerships necessary to build something known as the Maritime Collective, which hopefully will revitalize Santa Barbara's working waterfront. And that's why we're here today. And while we're talking about substituting boats on trailers for vehicles, it's really a lot more than that. This is the first step. And we're so proud that you have actually invited us here to explain that first step, because it's easy to bandy around the words sustainability, innovation, resilience. Well, this is just that. This is that kind of project. The fisheries of Santa Barbara and the state of California are definitely sustainable. And if you spend time with any commercial fisherman over there at that dock, you will realize that it's also a resilient industry. So we're asking you to take the first step with us to realize that, yes, there's going to be an impact, but what we think you're doing is a program, a partnership that actually focuses on an important sustainable industry and a goal that the city council has given both the Harbor Commission and the larger fishing community. In fact, part of the dialogue was that we have relied too much on tourism and hotel taxes. We need to diversify our economy. And when we see the rising trajectory of local seafood and seafood purchases in this community, we think this might be a way to add to the economic diversification of, as well as contribute to the economic recovery. So I think we're on the precipice of a great project. All we want to do is develop a great plan with you and move forward. So thank you very much for the opportunity to speak.
Thank you for speaking. All right, back to the board. Any discussion? Trustee Garrido.
Yes, well, first I want to thank you, Kim. And in full disclosure, I've known Mr. and Mrs. Halperin for many years. I am a lot of people's first grade and kindergarten teacher. And I am just so supportive of this vision from a teaching and learning standpoint, economic opportunity to introduce young people to the field of science, of life science, of ocean science. And then I love to eat. And so I frequent our restaurants, as you guys know, and I love seafood. And as a teacher, if you want to teach kids to read, you give them science. And that is something that putting kids in the water, taking them out to the harbor, the Maritime Museum. My Rotary Club just had our meeting yesterday at the Maritime Museum. And so I got a preview of this history. And I mean, I just was in awe. And so I am coming alongside all of you in your vision and the potential that this will have for innovation. And this is your college, so you have every right to have requested this. And I'm just so grateful that that we have the innovative leadership that is going to partner in such a multifaceted way for our entire community. So thank you.
And thank you for making the connection, Trustee Garrido. Trustee Stoddard.
I think this is on. Yeah. Okay. I'm in favor of the project, but I am concerned about the impact it will have on parking, because I know that that is such an issue for faculty and students already on campus. So I'd like to know more about that.
Thank you. Trustee Croninger.
I think it's a wonderful opportunity for us to look into this and understand the partnership potential. I think it looks really exciting. I am particularly interested from a student perspective in what kind of classes we could structure around this, career technical education, perhaps, and whether maybe some of our strong workforce funds could help support it as well. So I would encourage the idea of our staff really digging into this as a partnership and looking at it.
Agreed. Anybody else on the board? Okay, well, I just want to say, when we first heard about that this was the top producing port in California, I think there's a Santa Barbara Independent article a year or two ago. My first thought, I think I said it in my board report here, that this is something as Santa Barbara City College needs to get involved with. So I'm fully supportive. I liked what Mr. Nelson had to say about resiliency and sustainability and diversifying our local economy. And this just seems like something a community college is supposed to do. And I was glad to hear that you had support from our county supervisors, Hartman and Caps, our assembly member Hart, and the two city council members, Jordan and Friedman. So there is community support, and I do encourage us to go, you know, think big. You know, we can start here, and there's who knows what else we can do. So I'm fully supportive. Trustee Everett.
Yes, so am I. And I just wanted to say I appreciated your presentation very much. And my ears perked up too when I heard you mention about the need to diversify the all of the stakeholders, and particularly the ones who are working with you on this project, because I think that is so critical here at this college, where that's a big emphasis for us. But recognizing as an industry that that's something that you want to embrace was really something that I support. So thank you very much for at least flagging that.
Thank you. And yeah, I'm excited to see what our students can get involved with. I liked also what you had to say, that the average age keeps going up, and we do need to have more opportunities for people to get a job and stay in Santa Barbara. So do we have a motion from the board? We have a staff recommendation, which is to have our staff engage with the team of consultants at CFSB Cost to analyze the proposed use and available color property, as this proposal presents an opportunity. So do we have a motion to that effect?
I can move to approve.
Oh, but trust
recommendation.
Go ahead.
So we move to remove the recommendation for Santa Barbara City College to move forward and engage.
We have a second. Trustee Gallimore.
With the consultants that we're going to be looking at this proposal, will we also be providing an opportunity for the community to give feedback on this development, a possible development? And also with that consultant firm, or will we be conducting some kind of analysis on the benefits for the students, how it's going to impact the students, how it's going to impact our institution, because it's a storage facility, right? That's what they're asking for, a site to create more storage.
Yes, and I think there's an and here that I'd like to comment on, because it's important. They're proposing also partnership in some training programs and seeing what we do. So I just sent a note to Carola Smith and Maria Villa Gomez to work with Brian to look at the CTE and the programs that might coincide with this. That's the part too that for us is really interesting, because we're all about students. Mm-hmm. And we've got your concerns that you've raised, and we'll be back in front of you. And yes, it will be public.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, and I will just say, if you have a chance to visit Monterey, CSU Monterey, and when you look at some of our coastal Cal States and the thriving programs that they have with their local communities, it's really amazing. Of course, I spend a lot of time on all sorts of coasts because of my kids' sports, but that's also on your own for research. You'll see a lot of innovative things that community colleges have done based on their local ecosystem.
Well, maybe they can provide a compare and contrast in that report.
Great. Thank you. And I did see community engagement listed on your list of next steps. So it will be done. And so we don't have to do roll call votes anymore. So if we're ready to take a vote, we can call the vote, unless anybody has anything last thing to say. Does our student trustee have anything to bring up? No. All right. Well, let's everybody in favor say yes. Aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? All right, great. Motion passes immediately. We look forward to working with you all. Thank you. And next up, we're going to move into closed session. And so we're going to adjourn until 5 p.m. We'll be back here at 5. And our closed session items are conference with legal counsel on existing litigation and conference with legal counsel on anticipated litigation. So we will be back here at 5 p.m. Thank you all. to Maria.
Are you going to go train me on the building? Okay, okay. So that was too many times. You're going to the one at the end of this month. Yeah, yeah. Already, I'm gonna be in DC.
All right, so we're just gonna come back to order now. Just to report out from closed session on item 3.3, we had nothing to report. On item 3.2, I can say that the board voted to deny the appeal, and the vote was unanimous. And we're gonna move to section 5.1, which is public comment, and we do have one public comment. From Sally Sanger. So if we can move her into the participant or panelist room and take the public comment, please. I think you're ready to go, Sally. You got 5 minutes. Good to see you.
Okay, there I am. Yes, takes a little while to get hooked up here. Yes, well, I won't need 5 minutes. So thank you. I'm Sally Sanger, and I'm a part-time faculty member in all three areas of instruction at City College: credit, non-credit, and the fee-based life enrichment classes. And I'm familiar with some of you, and a few of you are fairly new to. I'm also a board member on the Faculty Association. And currently, I serve as president of the Faculty Association Non-Credit, which we affectionately call FAN. And that's why I'm here before you today. I want to introduce FAN to the new board members and just refresh the memories for those who already have some familiarity with FAN. And welcome, by the way, to the new board members. Thank you for your service. So the mission of FAN is to serve, represent, and advocate for all non-credit faculty in order to protect and promote the well-being of the members and to improve the conditions of teaching and learning. Our primary role at FAN is to negotiate with the district, as you know. That's for salaries, benefits, and working conditions for non-credit faculty. In addition, FAN may assist individual faculty in the event of employment-related disputes, and it helps to ensure that faculty members understand and enjoy the rights to which they are entitled. So besides those primary roles, FAN also aspires to promote unity among all academic employees, to provide a democratic voice campus-wide for non-credit faculty, to promote professional equity, parity, and inclusiveness, to provide legislative advocacy and representation statewide, and to strengthen the cause of non-credit education for the public good. And as I said, I teach in all three parts of the college division or college campus, and it's been for many years. I'm actually celebrating, what is this, the 41st year? So a long time. I believe that for non-credit faculty in all my years, that one of the most important things that an association does and what FAN does is to bring a sense of unity and solidarity to the non-credit faculty. Part-time faculty in general tend to be on the fringe of just about everything having to do with the college, and it's even more so with non-credit instructors. You've probably heard people say that organizing part-time faculty is like herding cats. Well, I can tell you that organizing non-credit part-time faculty is like herding feral cats. It's not easy, and some cats are just going to stay feral. Do the best we can as Faculty Association non-credit. These last few years, of course, during the pandemic, exacerbated the sense of disassociation and just feeling, I don't know, adrift or separate from colleagues and the community colleges as a whole. This is where FAN can make a difference. A sense of belonging is a critical factor in a healthy work environment, and your knowledge of and support for the association is important. So I thank you in advance for that support. Please feel free to reach out to me. And if you have any questions or comments, I'm very happy to connect with you. So thank you, and thank you for your service.
Thank you, Sally. Any questions about FAN? Nope. All right. Thank you. We'll move on to section 6, approval of the minutes. So I got a note that our December 15th minutes have some edits to be made from Trustee Croninger. So we could move that one to the next meeting. And Trustee Croninger, if you could send in your corrections, we'll get them addressed. So do we have a motion to approve the December 1st meeting minutes?
I move that we accept pending the movement of the corrected one to next meeting.
Okay. Do we have a second approving the minutes?
I'll second.
Okay, Trustee Miller, and let's take a vote. All voting yes.
Yes.
Aye.
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 Anyone voting no? Anyone abstaining? All right. Great. We're getting back used to the non-roll call votes. You know, it was easy with roll call, but we're getting back into the old way of doing things. Next up is 7, communication. So we're going to try with these reports this time. We're going to try to keep them to 4 to 5 minutes long just to help with the meeting times, especially since some of our late night decisions can sometimes be big ones, and we want to be ready to go to make them in the best of our abilities. So we're looking forward to hearing from our constituency leaders on what they are up to and what their organizations are up to and what their constituents are thinking on current issues. So we're looking forward to hearing first from Dr. Melanie Eckford Prosser, and she is on the Zoom, I believe. So go ahead. I think you're muted or our audio is off. Not hearing you. We're still not hearing you. Do you want to try reconnecting and we'll come right back to you? Okay. We'll go next. Actually, our student government president, Turner, is not available today. And so we'll move on next to CSCA with Liz. Liz is here. Just got to move her into panelists, and there we go.
There she is. Good afternoon, members of the board. Welcome to new board members. I want to say that CSCA is working on getting our contract ratified by our membership. Hopefully we'll have it done in a week or two. The only other thing I wanted to say is I wanted to acknowledge all the staff that are working hard to get classes started for next week. And, you know, last week was real tough because of the weather. And I appreciate Dr. Murillo letting people off on Monday and closing it on Tuesday. But I want to give a shout out, a big shout out to the people that are designated as essential personnel, especially the night custodians that came in during the rain and the dark. And the ones that could come in, I really want to get a shout out for all the good work they did and appreciate them for being able to come in as essential personnel and working that late at night into the early morning, all in the dark, all in the rain. So I want to express appreciation for that. And that's my report.
Thank you for the reminder on appreciating them. Let's go back to Academic Senate report. Let's try it out again. We still can't hear you now. But we have two others, so we can go back to them and give you some more time. So let's move on to 7.5, our Faculty Association report. Dr. Cornelia Alsheimer-Barthel.
Good afternoon, honorable members of the Board of Trustees, President Abboud, Dr. Murillo. Thank you for again having the Faculty Association on tonight's agenda. During winter break, the FA team has continued working on behalf of the SBCC faculty. Next slide, please. Here are the topics for my report today. Surely, I wish you all a very happy new year, and to everyone on campus, especially my faculty colleagues, a great start to our spring semester that is beginning on Monday. As always, I keep my report to you short and concise, mindful of the fact that you have packed agendas. This being said, it was shared with me by our administration, and President Abboud has mentioned it again today, that you are planning to implement a time limit for our constituency reports. And if I heard the number right, you said there's a limit of about 4 minutes. Honestly, I don't think that this is a good idea. I believe that such a time limit on us appears to contradict completely the purpose of why you are asking us to be here. You want to learn from us what is going on at this college, things you might not hear from the administration. Furthermore, I would like you to please keep in mind how such a limitation is perceived by our employees and students whom we represent. This said, I want to be cognizant of my speaking time and come to the next topic right away. We just learned that there is now a plan to call our long-awaited Budget Sustainability Workgroup for its very first meeting in February. This is highly appreciated. The FA has always supported this workgroup since it was approved in June last year, and we are very eager to get it now started soon. And please allow me to take this opportunity to again reconfirm the FA support for the all-important workgroup on ranking on management and staff hiring decisions, which CPC had unanimously approved back in November 2021. The FA has not given up hope that this important group will actually happen at some point. And this takes me to the very last topic on my list, but definitely an extremely important one, our ongoing contract negotiations. A quick recap of the timeline. On September 15th, the FA submitted our well-reasoned COLA proposal for the current year 2022-2023 to the administration. It was then forwarded to you, the board, on December 15th. The district negotiation team shared your first response with the FA the following day, which we very much appreciated. From what was presented to us, your response at that time was very general in nature. And given that last month we did not yet have a lot of information where the governor's future plans for higher education funding would take us, we understand this. But this has changed now. As of last week, we all heard the good news from Sacramento. The governor made it very clear that education will continue to be a priority for him by proposing an 8.13% COLA for the upcoming year for us. This is even higher than the 6.56% COLA, plus other new and ongoing monies that the district has been receiving since last summer. However, the employees have not yet benefited from this in any way. This is especially concerning as the people who work here are faced with continuing higher rents, higher gas bills, higher food prices. So the FA is very hopeful that in light of this powerful message from our governor, we will now see that the conclusion of the 22-23 COLA negotiations will be a top priority, not only for the employee groups, but for all of us. Next slide, please. As always, please let me know if you have any questions. And if not, I wish you a very successful rest of the meeting today.
Thank you for the report. Any questions? And Cornelia, I'd love to talk with you. If you're still around at the end of the meeting, we can talk
Thank
about
you.
That reports thing. Thank you. Can we go back to Melanie at Academic Senate? We can test that out again. We are still not hearing you, I think.
Might be a suggestion, Melanie, maybe you could call in and we could at least hear you.
Let's try that. So we'll give another pause and we'll go to board committee reports before we go back to Academic Senate. So I know Finance Committee met. Do we have a report?
We do. And it was a pretty interesting meeting. We had a brief discussion of the rates for our non-resident students, but we don't have anything from the chancellor's office yet, so there really wasn't a lot to talk about yet. We had the monthly budget update, which is on the agenda today, and I think we'll hear about it then, but basically we expect future reports to have more transparency, particularly around significant changes in our ending balances as we look toward the end of the year. And appreciate the support of Brian Fahnestock and Rudy in heading that way. The January governor's budget, Rudy presented an excellent summary of that and a PowerPoint, and I think it's going to be attached to the agenda of the committee. So I would suggest if people want to look at that, that was very helpful. Basically, it's a good proposal for community colleges, but from our perspective, what is really missing is an increase in the base amount. And that's kind of a continual conversation back and forth with the chancellor's office and the governor's office. I remember it from last year. Next, we had a discussion of the reserve calculation. And this is board policy, which requires our board, our reserves to have 5% minimum general fund contingency plus, in the current situation with no deferrals, 15% of annual projected unrestricted general fund expenditures. And the issue is how to calculate expenditures. When this originally came into play, I understood it to mean the number we see at the bottom of the line that says total expenditures on our budget. And I think pretty much everybody understood it that way. But very recently, I happened to do the math and realized that it wasn't being calculated that way. So it turns out that we were calculating our reserves, omitting transfers out, which includes a variety of things, whether it's money to food service, bookstore, children's center, and equipment and construction that we basically expect to spend. So that's 3.9 million this year and was excluded from the calculation. And other outgo, which is not usually much money on unrestricted general reserves, and contingency, which is a relatively new line item, which is 5.4 million. So there's a significant impact to how you come out on the reserves. Apparently this method of calculation has been in there forever. It's we just as a board didn't know about that. And so we never discussed it. I think that the general agreement of the committee was that we need to clarify the policy in a number of ways. The place and meaning of the contingency line item needs to be perhaps clearer what that is about. And that the original intent of the policy was that all operating expenditures were used to calculate that percent. This is a really good time to make this adjustment because we do have undesignated reserves. So we're not looking to put more money in the budget or save money to make up any difference. We can just recalculate and we will be there. The last item, second to last item, but a report from Dr. Murillo. First of all, as Cornelia just mentioned, the budget sustainability work group will start, we think, in February with assistance from Cambridge Group, is it?
Cambridge West.
And we also had a review by Brian Fahnestock of the history of the cost estimates for the PE building, which was very helpful. We only just looked at it briefly that day, but I suggest it's attached to the agenda item as well under Dr. Murillo's report, and I would suggest everyone would be interested in reading that. It takes the history from June of 2016, when the total construction cost was 30.6 million. And our local contribution was $170,000. That's when the board first approved it, to the current construction estimates of $75 million for a total construction with a local match of $40 million. There's a sticker shock in there, certainly for me. With some costs still to be calculated and included. So that number, those numbers for current are not done yet. For example, swing space, we can guesstimate, and I know Brian had done a guesstimate on that, but there are also some uncovered costs in landscaping, parking, updating, construction costs, escalation, and so forth, need to be kind of refining it. And we also agreed that an independent firm would be a good idea to do another cost estimate. So we have a check on how good our estimates are. And that's something Dr. Murillo recommended to us. Finally, we discussed issues related to recent concerns about the rise of groundwater above sea level rise and a map of projections that Brian located from with help from the city. And the recent rains have really highlighted these issues to the forefront of thinking. And it's at a preliminary stage and really needs a lot more discussion, investigation as to what it might mean. For example, and I don't know if this is correct, but what I recall about the liquefaction issue was it was going to be a soil mixing response. But if you have groundwater rise, then it may be caissons as well. It may not, soil mixing might not do it. You might be floating around on the groundwater, basically. So what is the depth of groundwater, the geology at depth, and potential impact of groundwater flooding on the use and lifespan of the building are all complicated questions. I mean, these are not simple things. We therefore felt that a special board meeting to discuss all of this, the estimates, the considerations of the groundwater levels, and all of the complicated factors that go into this, it really should be one special meeting of the board where we can focus on it. So
I agree with that. And do we have any other committees that met? Any other reports? Let's go back to Academic Senate. Let's try. Oh, yes, Trustee Everett.
I'd just like to say that I did attend the Audit and Finance Committee yesterday, and I wanted to acknowledge and appreciate Vice President Fernstrup, who just got here, as he said, 15 minutes ago, and he did a great job on that, the PE building, among other things. So just thank you. It was a pleasure to meet you virtually and now to see you in person.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Anna, because I really should have mentioned that Brian, Rudy, and Raquel all really did a great job for us.
Thank you, Brian. Let's try again with Melanie. And I see the call-in number in there, so let's see how it works.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes, yes. We got you.
I know, the television commercial. This is punishment for zooming in. I'm looking forward to being in person. It's going to be harder for me to be lost in person on the next meeting. So hello, board members, old and new. Hello and congratulations to you, President Abood. I'm Melanie Eckford-Prosser, Academic Senate President, and I have just a quick overview of where the Senate is at the start of this year. We ended 2022 by starting a discussion about academic freedom, which we will continue this semester. And our perhaps ambitious goal is to vote on an AP on academic freedom by the end of this semester. We're also working through the second year of a pilot on anti-racist hiring practices, and we hope to complete a new AP on faculty hiring by the end of this semester. Looking forward, and the Senate hasn't met since mid-December, I expect one of the most immediate concerns of faculty will be ChatGPT, the AI. To me, academic freedom envisioned not as polarizing, not as exclusive, but as inclusive and based in equity. That kind of academic freedom, along with the rise of AI such as ChatGPT, force all of us to consider the question of the kind of college we want to be. And let me be clear here, this is not in terms of right sizing, but in terms of how we value knowledge and the practices we use to enact that value, such as pedagogy, new innovative courses, and so on. And I think we're going to have to be very cognizant of the effect of technology on all of those things. During the fall, we took time to explain strategic enrollment management in detail to chairs as well as deans. Gensler has taken time to gather input on our strategic plan. And on Tuesday, CPC considered what it would mean to lift the plan. And as you know, we are underway on the search for the new president superintendent, which will be hard to fill interim President Murillo's shoes, but we're giving it a shot. So we are on the way. This semester, however, we must ensure that we become a college grounded in equity and anti-racism, grounded in a robust understanding of academic freedom, and fully committed to excellence in teaching so that we meet our students where they are and help them get where they want to be. And with that, I look forward to working with you this semester. And if you have any questions, happy to answer them.
Thank you. Any questions? All right. Thank you. And then last up is our report from our interim superintendent president, Dr. Kindred Murillo.
Thank you. Just a couple of comments. Welcome, Brian, and thank you for you hit the ground running, and we inundated with you with a ton of things. So we appreciate all of the efforts. I do want to note that we are going to try to schedule a facilities and community relations meeting for next week, now that we think we have a relatively good idea of what our costs would be on the physical education building. We will be presenting those to you. We are very concerned about the groundwater issue and the location of the PE facility, and we'll be pursuing that. It's very concerning because the way the chancellor's office has set up the physical education building is we are supposed to replace it exactly where it's at. And it's a life safety project, which is something we have to really think about. So we will be looking at all of that. But so we'll be looking forward to meeting with the group. And then we will schedule a study session sometime, hopefully in February, for the whole board to talk about the physical education building. So that's kind of where we are. We will be starting the fiscal sustainability group to try to move along this semester. That project would like to really get that off the ground before I leave, because I know that's an important issue for the board and has been for a long time. So we're looking forward to getting that done. And I think that's it for me today, unless you have any questions.
Thank you. Any questions? Yes.
Yeah, Kindred, can I request that for that special board meeting, and I'm sure we will because we have an amazing PE department faculty, but I'd like for them to have ample time to really prepare, because this has not been a unanimous board. So I know, Marcia, this has not been your priority project, and for good reason, right? You have your different point of view, but this is a project that I have a lot of history on. And so when we get into our facilities committee meeting, which I'm happy to chair because I have a lot of history with it and willing to put in the work with our PE faculty and everybody, but I do want them on board because they have a lot of history and we have a lot of documents. And as the revolving door presidents have come through this college, if we all sat down and put all our heads together, we'll all eventually get to the correct document. But I assume just hearing Marcia's report that there's a lot of information out there that just needs to get clarified, and it's going to be a good time for our newer board members and then even Anna, who in 2018 was not here. So if I don't know what the scope and timeline of that would look like, but this is going to be a big project from the participatory standpoint, and our PE department needs to be on the ground.
Good suggestion to have them able to be here when we have our meeting. Any other comments or questions for Dr. Murillo? Okay. Next is our consent agenda. So on the consent agenda, again, it's 9, 10, 11, 12, and 13. So business services, school of extended learning, student affairs, academic affairs, and human resources. We don't have anything this time on student affairs and school of extended learning. So does anybody have anything to pull from the consent agenda that you want to vote on separately or have questions about? If not, we can have a motion to approve the entire consent agenda. Trustee Kroninger.
13.1. Sorry.
Okay. We will pull 13.1 for now. Anyone else pulling something?
I believe that's the same one, but I can't see it from there, but also 10.1.
10.1, the sabbatical leaves?
Yes.
Okay. So we're pulling sabbatical leaves for 23-24 and approval of independent contractor agreements. Do we have a motion to approve the rest of the consent agenda?
So moved.
Thank you. And do we have a second? Trustee Croninger. So we have a second, and let's take a vote on the consent agenda minus the two. Everyone voting yes?
Can I just confirm, because it's not, the attachment's not loading, is 13.1 the enrollment contractor? Is that that one?
Is it? Yeah, it's a list of many. Let's see.
It's three of them. Independent contractor agreements.
One for the airport.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Then that's it.
Great. So let's take our vote on the rest. So everyone voting yes, vote yes. Aye. Yes.
Aye.
Yes. Everyone voting no. Anyone abstaining? Okay. So we'll move. Consent agenda is approved, but we'll go now to 10.1, which is sabbatical leaves, 23-24. Trustee Garrett, do you have questions? Or?
Yes, thank you. So I'm supportive of sabbatical leaves. I understand the teaching and learning benefit and all of that. So just want to preface it with that. My question is more around, again, going back to the revolving door presidents we've had. This is an item that year after year after year, we have been told that we're going to get more information on. The amount of sabbaticals that we have for the size of the college has always been an issue that has been brought up, as that is too large of a team to go out for the size of Santa Barbara City College. I understand the history with collective bargaining and all the different moving parts here. We haven't had the update, the information, but this keeps happening every year. And given the forecast, the budget, the PE building, all of the different things that we're looking at, what can you tell us if you know anything about it? I'm not comfortable approving it because we approve them every single year. And yet we have not been given the information that we've discussed. And I know it's the first you've heard, because Kendra, you're doing the best you can, but we just can't keep doing this. And I need more information as to what does this look like for Santa Barbara City College? That's a lot of people to go out.
So I'd be happy to pull together some information for you. This is the first I've heard of this request. So I will just say that, and I'm sure Vice President Villa Gomez, it's probably her first opportunity to hear this. I will tell you that just the numbers I see for sabbatical here are not that high for the size of a college. And I worked at a small college. I've worked at a large district. I've worked at a medium college. And actually, this is very medium. I worked in a college where sabbaticals are right every 6 years. In other words, the faculty literally go out and point blank in period. So just from an eyeball kind of point of view, I would say these numbers don't seem high to me, because usually it is something that's important for the faculty development. And this many sabbaticals seems about right for a college our size. So we'll come back with more information. But again, just seeing what I've seen the last 2 years, this doesn't seem like an overboard number for a college this size.
And then the sabbatical committee was also going to provide to us a report in terms of some standards for the work being done. And there's different ranges of the type of work that happens this, but that was something that internally folks recognize, that, you know, this is a time for teaching and learning, something that was going to enhance and impact and further the mission or enhance something, and putting some standards around that. So that report is still pending.
We'll provide you a report. So
thank you.
Anybody else on this item have comments or questions? Trustee Everett.
I just want to add briefly that sabbaticals are crucial to faculty development and keeping up with their fields. And the description of the sabbatical requests are sufficient in terms of outlining what the projects are. So I'm a little confused about what the question is for sabbaticals. But I just wanted to add that it's really crucial, and it's an important element in professional development, field updates, and keeping our students up to date with state-of-the-art information and changes in fields. Thank you.
Yeah, we agree with that. The history was the faculty recognizing that they wanted to standardize this to make sure that there was some metrics in terms of evaluating the work that's being done. And as colleagues present, I mean, we had, you know, just different examples of different presentations that came forward, and everybody just wanted to continue that work of elevating Santa Barbara City College and making sure that the work output is consistent. And that was, that came out of the faculty. We just never got the report, so.
Trustee Gallupmore.
I agree with our colleagues here about the request for a report highlighting the standards, because just reading the sabbatical reports that were provided, they vary in length, they vary in degree of information. And I kind of was trying to understand, well, what is the significance of having to travel if you're taking a sabbatical in regards to this type of program or this type of course versus no one else is traveling? So I would like to see a report about what are the standards and possibly the impact of previous sabbaticals. How did it benefit our institution? Mm-hmm.
And we will get some of the sabbaticals as a report to the board. So that'll be something to look out for. You'll see the different kinds of reports we get. Trustee Miller.
I'd just like to comment that I read through the, there are five summaries. And I was pleased to see that for the most part, they were student success oriented. Faculty members that did their proposals were focused on what they could do to help students succeed, as opposed to just focusing on what the faculty member can do to make them a better faculty member, and which is an important factor. But I just was really pleased compared to other years that there clearly was a focus on student success.
Anybody else? Comments, questions? Trustee Kuhlinger.
I would just say I agree with Robert. That's what I look for when I read these. How is it going to help our students? And obviously there's a connection with being a better teacher, but sometimes that connection was pretty weak in the past, shall we say, more about what a faculty member might want to do and less about how it will help the students. So I think that this has gotten a lot better. And what Veronica may be asking for is, you know, tell us about that.
Do we have a motion? Oh, does our student trustee have anything to add on this? Great. Do we have a motion to approve the sabbatical leaves for 23-24?
Also move.
Motion. We
have second.
Second. Let's take a vote. Everyone voting yes, vote yes.
Aye.
Yes.
Aye. Yes. Everyone voting no? Everyone abstaining? All right. We have a unanimous vote. Next up, we'll go to 13.1, independent contractor agreements. We had two trustees on this one, but Trustee Kuhlinger, do you want to go first on 13.1?
Okay. I mentioned this earlier to Dr. Murillo, but not this week, I guess, a while ago. Anyway, I am concerned. I'm not in favor of advertising at the airport. I feel like the focus of our enrollment outreach and efforts should be on reaching our economically disadvantaged students and members of the community, and they are not found at the airport. They can't afford to fly around. And so I just feel like that money would be better spent on outreach to our economically disadvantaged populations and basically meeting them where they are. And I think a lot could be done if we had a focused approach on where can we find these people. I mean, the chancellor's office, I understand, is interested particularly in, what was it, 35 and older adults, that we should be looking to increase our enrollment there. We do a lot with our high schools, but there may be more. And I think, you know, Veronica, you may want to comment on this about where our Latino families in particular, if we outreach, where should we go? The churches, the community institutions that we have in our community that we could spend our time. And I think a lot of this is actually people personally doing the work. It's not doing a poster or that kind of advertising, and I'd rather spend the money on that. But even in the poster advertising, a bus ad to me is more effective because you're going to have more people in a broader cross section of people seeing that ad.
Thank you. Trustee Gerda, you had mentioned this one to Paul as well.
Yeah, thank you. Well, the first thing is the contracts aren't there. And so I think that that's the first problem, that we need to see the contract if we're going to prove it.
These are actually, I thought this was worked out a long time ago before I ever got here, is these particular ones, they don't have the full contract in them because they're our standard contract. And the only difference is what we just put in the section that says vendor description of service. So it is our set contract that was worked out. What year?
Two or three years ago, we had our legal counsel put together a standard contract, and really you're filling in the name, the amount of money and the scope of work and the dates.
I mean, we can include them. They just basically all say the same thing except for the scope of work.
Yeah, I understand. I thought that, so yes, I think going forward, and I had made that request before, I don't think we should ever be approving anything without documenting the scope of the work. It's just public transparency and just for people to continue to trust the fiduciary responsibility here at this table. And so that I think is important. So I would recommend to put this aside, bring it back and put the full scope of what's happening there. It's just good practice. That was my first comment. Then looking at individually of what we're trying to award here, the finance, the LLC, KN and public finance, this is a larger discussion. And so in support of a 2024 general bond activity, we're not there yet. And so $100,000, I don't think that this is part of any larger conversation. We had left off with this wasn't the right time, but this hasn't come back to the facilities committee or anything yet. So I think that this one, my recommendation would be to hold it until we have a larger conversation. And my thinking in this is we want to make sure that we're sequential and that we are having people follow us with every step of the way. And we don't have any public dialogue or discussion in terms of the rationale for bringing KN in. I'm not saying it's the wrong thing to do, but it's not in a sequence where someone can follow the storyline here.
So I would like to advise you that you have an annual continuing disclosure filing that KNN's been doing for you for years on your old bond. That has to be done, and they've been doing it for us. And the annual debt transparency reporting, that is a service that they've also been doing. So those have to be done. We're required to do them, and you've had them do this before. The reason I added the piece about the general obligation bond is we were asking for a two-year contract so that as you start prepping, that you will have a financial advisor on hand to help you with your advice. And then we also, with the physical education building, we might have to look at financing. So we also would be working with a financial advisor to make sure that that we would do the right things with a general obligation bond. I will tell you from my past experience with working with bonds, I recommend never to do any kind of prepping for financing without a financial advisor to help the district. It saves you a lot of money. It means you don't get taken advantage of by underwriters. So there are some services in this that are important that we are required to do. And we're just basically updating a prior contract. So
yeah, I understand that. So that gives back to my original point. We need to see the scope of this because we're not going to prematurely add to their scope 2024 general obligation bond activity. Yes, it may be appropriate. It's definitely where we may or may not be going, but it's not following a sequence where someone can follow this. So I recommend that we bring this back, put the full contract there, just outline the scope of the work, highlight what we've added. I think that it's appropriate. I'm not in a disagreement with what you're saying. I recognize the work that has to happen, that needs to happen. But in order for us to go out there and knock on a door and answer the questions, it's going to start with simple things like this. And we technically don't have the scope of the work in front of us. And it's just a gesture of courtesy to the community. And it's going to help us answer the questions when we get there. For the media consult, I also agree that the 30,000 is perhaps not in the best interest right now. And one thing that's also pending is an enrollment report. We haven't looked at enrollment strategies and what we're doing to outreach. And so how this may or may not be the right course of action with our overall enrollment management plan. I recognize the last time we had that was when Dr. Jarrell was here. That was Anthony. And again, with the revolving door presidents, we just haven't gotten that one on the table yet. So I would also pull that one. And then the video, that probably just, it seems like it's some marketing for outreach. I'm assuming, I'm not sure. I mean, I've seen a lot of other colleges do that one, but you can tell us more. So that's my recommendation. I would say, like Marsha and the airport marketing, perhaps not the right thing, maybe, but maybe some more information attaching it to enrollment management. And then for sure, the LLC one, come back with the full scope.
Trustee Miller.
I just would like to comment on the airport advertising issue. I think Marsha raised some legitimate comments, as did Veronica, but I don't think any of us are advertising experts. So I think it probably is a case of needing more information. I assume they had a strategy in mind, a focus in mind when they decided to do that. And I'd like to hear that before we say yes or no.
Yeah, I really do think that you ought to hear from Martha on that particular one, because this has been a strategy that some other colleges have used too. So go ahead.
Hello. So as you all know, I oversee the college's overall marketing and advertising. Obviously, the college has a variety of targets. Marsha and Veronica, you both rightfully pointed out that our local students are absolutely key. But we do also need to reach students for out of state. We know that that's an important part of the enrollment management puzzle and in terms of getting revenue for the college as well. So this was a new strategy that I wanted to implement for our out of state students with the added benefit of also hitting local families and students. Yes, they may not be typically the ones who are the neediest, though with the addition of Southwest to SBA, I think that flying out of SBA has gotten more affordable. You also have to consider the fact that many locals work at the airport. So I think it's a good place for local brand awareness. And you mentioned MTD. That is also a part of the strategy that I'm looking to implement. Well, as I think you all know by now, I'm actually leaving the college in a week. But part of the plan that my team will hopefully carry on in my stead is an advertising campaign with MTD as well. When I got here almost a year and a half ago, the college had all but stopped doing general brand awareness campaigns. They had only been doing targeted campaigns around enrollment periods. And I personally find that a bit short-sighted, and we need to be in the market year-round. So that's why I was looking for strategies that we could do year-round. So in the last year, we have started doing social media and Google AdWords year-round. And then things like this physical, more traditional advertising, we wanted to add to the mix as well, because any good advertising plan is going to have that mix. So that's why, and in Santa Barbara, I will tell you, we don't have the luxury of having billboards, which many colleges use, but they are, as I think you all, you may or may not realize, literally not allowed within, at least in, I don't know if it's the whole county, but I know it is within Santa Barbara City. There are no billboards. So the only sort of thing that you can do like that is our MTD buses. And the airport's another spot. And for certain tourism-based industries, there's a few other options. But for us, these were two things that were going to make sense. So I guess I can conclude by telling you, you will hopefully see a contract with MTD coming through in the next few months. And I also want to assure you that past contracts that you have approved with a firm called Wells Marketing have run the gamut of covering a variety of local media outlets, including Spanish language radio. You just don't see the individual media outlets on there, but they're all a part of our plan.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Trustee Everett.
Yes, I just like to say, as a media scholar and professional, I do support what you're saying, because it is the case that brand awareness is key, and we are going to be ramping up our enrollment push for improving and increasing enrollment. And I think that this approach, along with what Trustee Croninger was saying, the targeted outreach is going to be so important, but this is really key. And I want to thank you for all of the commercials that I see on television, local television, about the school is really powerful and they're good. So sorry to see you go, really. And I think this is a good program. I think it's important.
Thank you very much. And just to respond to one other thing, Marcia, you mentioned local high schools. A couple of months ago, actually, I think just in November or December, you approved a contract with a firm called Glacier. And I'm pleased to tell you, I can let you know that the work with them is well underway and our campaign will be launching in mid-February. And that's doing geo-targeted social media and digital advertising to all of our local high school students. So we're targeting by zip code and by school. And we also just found out that we got approval to be in 3 local high schools and 3 more are pending for large 3x4 posters on walls in the local high schools. And we'll be highlighting the promise and our transfer guarantee program there.
Excellent. Thank you. Yeah, Marcia.
So I feel like getting into a lengthy discussion on this would take us beyond the agenda, perhaps. And the kind of information that I'm interested in is a lot more detailed. Really. I can understand the brand awareness concept, but I would really like to hear about the outreach to our socioeconomically disadvantaged students. What are we doing there? What are our success rates in these different kinds of advertising efforts? How big is the overall budget? How are we dividing it up? There's a whole lot of stuff there, and I wouldn't expect you to be prepared to tell us about it, and it feels inappropriate to have that level of a discussion. So my suggestion is that we put it off, have that discussion, and then come back to the idea of what we think is the most important focus for our efforts here. We're getting state money for this. I mean, it's real money to increase enrollment, and I would like us to know what we're up to.
Yes.
Trustee Miller.
I agree with that completely. I think it would be good for us to hear what the strategy is and where we are spending our advertising dollars. But I'd also like to take the opportunity to echo what Trustee Everett said. I don't watch much TV, but when I do lately, I have seen really great ads about Santa Barbara City College. And I started to say to myself that this is not just good for enrollment. If we have a bond measure in 2024, this has to be helpful for that as well, because it builds, I think, in the community, confidence in Santa Barbara City College, and in advertising reminds people who we are and what we do and what a great place this is.
Thank you.
Trustee Gallatmore.
I just want to also echo Trustee Croninger. I agree with your recommendation on having more detail. I'm a huge fan of public relations, and so I've seen the activity on social media, and whoever's doing it, you're doing a great job. I got a mailer for the very first time last year, and I've seen some ads in the paper, so that makes sense to me. Advertisement at the airport, when I know we do have other areas where we need to improve upon our messaging and our PR, I also agree with Trustee Croninger. That right there doesn't ring a bell with me. I think maybe if we could just put a hold on it just to get more details and come back. I'm not saying that your recommendations and your strategy is not ideal for what we're trying to do as an institution, but it would help us to feel more comfortable making these decisions when we can see how the money is being utilized and what areas we're targeting and what new areas we're targeting. And if we could actually kind of quantify the impact of targeting areas we haven't been before as far as our PR process.
Yeah, I mean, I want to thank you because I do travel frequently. And I did see the beautiful poster when I was getting my luggage. And it was beautiful. What Marcia is alluding, I think it was Cal State Fullerton, when Mildred Garcia, then president, and this was maybe 2017, 18, she took her outreach to the churches, to the Baptist churches, to the Catholic churches. San Bernardino County Superintendent and Riverside County Superintendent both just signed a memorandum of understanding with the Archdiocese and they're taking their efforts to, you know, so it's really getting creative to go where the people are and the communities are. I think of in public health, the promotoras. And so for 30 grand, you can get a lot of promotoras out there in the community. And it's not just outreach. It's literally like with their iPad enrolling people. And so I want us to think really big in terms of the people that we have right across the street at Rancheria down the hill. It's not going to cost us $30,000. And maybe we will spend that later. But I really want to see some of us do even better innovation than what some of our sister community college CSU partnerships are doing, because it's more than just the poster. It's the 10 or 20, whatever, how many steps of enrollment we have besides the application.
You're absolutely right. And I can tell you that my colleagues in enrollment services, and I'm sure Vice President Arnold could speak to this as well, they are doing that on the ground outreach. Again, respectfully, combining that with the work that comes out of my office is what's needed to maintain the college's reputation and position us well for future success and ongoing success.
Trustee Gullett-Moore. Oh, Martha, you don't have to say if you don't
okay,
want to.
Okay, yeah. I'm happy to answer any questions. This is my passion, so I'm happy to talk about it. And I hope that we can get it approved, because if it matters, I know that there is limited space at the airport. And when we tentatively agreed, you know, said that we would take this for your approval. You know, it is being held for us. There are competitors of ours who would jump on it if we didn't take it now.
Thank you.
And just one more thing. Again, the details, right? Because I would like to see if the PR department is collaborating with other departments like admissions, enrollment, dual enrollment, the promise, and helping to target how can we increase the numbers in terms of student representation. So if we still are only having 8% African-American students in one particular program group, how can we increase that? If we only having a certain percentage of Asian students in a certain programs, how can we increase that? So I just would like to see more details on how we are working within the college with other departments and representation as far as the optics when we create these pamphlets and these posters. What are we saying who are already here and who we would like to come? So we should be thinking about those things as well.
It sounds like a great study session topic. Mm-hmm. Once we have a new executive director for public affairs, I'm sure they'll bring that to us for a great discussion at a future study session. Trustee Croninger?
Yeah, I would add to what Charlotte just said that we have a tremendous resource in our foundation and their connections to the community. And I think we should work with them as well as a partner to develop this outreach and program. Because I just envision we can do a lot more in different areas. We're just not there. And I you tell me, Veronica, I don't think we are in the churches, poster or otherwise. And I don't think that a poster at the airport speaks to the people who are baggage handlers or janitors. I think they feel like it's not meant for them. So it's very uncomfortable for me. That's why I bring it up.
Yes, Carola, did you? Can I step in for a minute? Because like we're just getting hit with this now and the agenda's been posted for almost a week. And so I feel like I put my staff in a very bad place because usually you guys let me know if you have a real problem with an agenda item. And so we're sitting here trying to, if I had known this was a big concern, we would have brought you a full report of all the collaboration that's going on with enrollment services, all of the collaboration that's going on with the SEL, all of the collaboration that's going on with the foundation and the marketing department. That's what Martha does all day long, every day, is with these colleagues sitting there working through all these strategies to make sure that we are marketing in the community so that we're hitting every possible person we possibly can with the emphasis on our underserved students. So I feel like we just kind of got put in a really bad place because we weren't really aware that this was a big deal. You made one comment to me.
Yeah, so. I said I felt strongly about it. So I apologize for not reiterating that this week. But it's not just about collaborating internally. In my mind, it's about collaborating externally with all of the resources in our community that help us with that outreach. And that's particular emphasis that I would want to hear about, you know.
So we would have had that report for you tonight if I had. Yeah. been told that.
But I didn't know we were going that direction. I mean, I'm just saying airport is not a priority for me. I think this money could be spent better elsewhere. It makes me uncomfortable to think we are. I mean, we already have a reputation as the rich kids college, frankly. And we were statistically the rich kid, number one of all the community colleges in the United States, of having the richest overall parent base when a study, a big data study was done a number of years ago. So everything we do for our economically disadvantaged members of this community is a priority for me. And recruiting more of the folks that really have the advantage is less of a priority.
Thank you. I think, Coral, did you have your hand up? Kendra, you said you were going to pass over.
Good evening. Thank you for the opportunity to comment. I just wanted to point out that through the School of Extended Learning, we are actually starting to be present at a number of community organizations, including churches where they are doing, let's say, food shares, or they're handing out clothing, etc. So we have started a list of events where we actually are present to hand out information about our programs. We collaborate with the library and with the number of entities to get the word out and to actually be where the potential students are. So just for your information.
Thank you.
Thank you. And one thing I'll say is this is a really fun topic. How do we advertise and get the college's name out there? I know we have a lot of things to say about that. I do think we're getting a little into the weeds right now. So I think, you know, we got to remember our role as a policymaking body. I think it'd be great if we had a study session where we had a report of how the current marketing department functions and ideas we might be able to share as community representatives. That'd be great. But I think we're getting a little too nitty gritty of like telling people exactly how to do their jobs right now. But I do think that we should have a board discussion of what our priorities are for marketing and outreach, because we have a lot of good ideas. It's something everybody has a lot to say about, but that's not really what's on the agenda today. It's approving this contract or not. So let's consider that. And then we will definitely promise you a board meeting soon on this topic. Trustee Stoddard.
I just wanted to say that, I hear Marcia's concern, but I also, what Robert said really resonated with me in terms of just as a branding at the airport for the bond that we hope we're going to be able to pass. You know, I mean, those people need to see our name places as well. And I'm listening to what Martha said about the there's not very many places to put things, you know. I mean, you can't have a billboard. And I'm just thinking in my mind, where do I see posters for Santa Barbara City College? You know, and I see them on the internet is where I see them. Yeah. So, but I don't see them, you know, I don't know. Yeah. So that's all. Thank you.
Any other comments or questions? And I'd also love to hear a motion as well.
I just wondering if you could tell us about the production, Kindred. What is the production?
I would actually this is Paloma. Get into the details.
Not now.
Well, I don't want to go. I mean, I'm just, yeah. You know. Answer the questions.
Trustee Gallardo, your question was regarding the 7 minute to success.
Yeah, what is it?
Sure. So this was a proposal that the athletic department put together for the Student Equity and Achievement Committee. Every spring we request proposals for small funding opportunities. And their proposal was to put together short videos to put before certain instructional classes to see if that changed sort of the ability of the students to participate and benefit, because there's a lot of research about around how physical activity increases participation and concentration and success in classes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Do we have a Trustee Miller before we go to a motion?
Yes, I was looking here what the number is,
13.1.
I would move that the adoption of the approval of item 13.1.
Second.
Oh, could we approve 10 point, I don't think we did a motion for 10.1.
Yeah, we did.
Oh, we did. Yeah, okay, did. Sorry. Got mixed up. Okay, let's do, so if we got a first and a second, great. Let's take a vote. Everyone voting yes. Go ahead now.
Aye.
Yes.
Can we take him out? Can I? I'm going to vote no on the first two, but I'm okay with the video. That's very self-explanatory. So can we amend your motion for to approve KNN Public Finance LLC, Fuse Connect LLC?
You want to do two separate motions mm-hmm. on the first two and a separate motion for the last one?
That is correct.
It's up to the motion makers.
Because I'm the J North Productions is very clear.
Okay, I'll amend the motion to apply to item one and item three on item 13.1. Items one and three.
One and two. You want to approve one and two.
I want to approve all of them, but we're going to take it one step at a time. And you.
But you're mixing the ones that we're trying to vote on. I think it's either three or one and two.
I think Trustee Gerda wants to vote separately on three aside from one and two.
Yeah.
But that's up to you. As
the I think I'm just going to stick with the original motion.
Sounds good. So
second.
We'll stick with the original motion then. So we'll go to a vote on the motion to approve 13.1. So everyone voting yes, go ahead. Yes.
Aye.
Yes. Abstain.
Everyone voting no?
No.
No.
No. Two no's and then abstains. So we have one abstain. So we have four yeses, two no's, and one abstain. Yeah. So that it does pass.
I'm sorry. Could we repeat just the no's and the abstain? I didn't catch that.
Trustee Gullett-Moore, I abstain.
Groninger and Gallardo voted no.
Thank you.
And in the future, can we have them separately? Because I think the number three is important. We agree. And so to force us to vote no on number three was really unfair when it was clear that we were differentiating between not having contracts present, not having the scope, and needing more information. So for the future, it'd be nice to just bring these contracts as separate little items. It makes it clean.
We'll look at the contract process that we put in place before I got here. So
completely understand.
We'll work on it. We'll work on it. All right. So next is good discussion, but we'll have more to say on outreach. Next is 15.1, which is our AP 3435 discrimination and harassment complaints and investigation. It's an informational item. Dr. Murray, do you have a report on this?
I'm not going to speak very long. It is an information item. It's been a long time coming, getting this updated. And I want to thank Denitris Lewis, Craig Price, who is our attorney, and Linda Dozier for their work on AP 3435. We are now in compliance with the state, and this is an information item for the board. And I do want to say we are really working hard as a district to make sure we comply with it.
Thank you. And this was part of Resolution 18, is getting our complaints process to be airtight. Thank you for making it happen. Anybody have questions or comments on this? Okay.
Is there a high level of any major changes that?
I'm sorry?
Is there just a high level of any major changes or anything worthy of public?
I think what's really important about it is it complies with the regulations that have been changing dramatically over time. And we've been trying to keep up with them. So I think that's the part. I can actually at some point have Linda come in and give you guys an overview of sort of the process. I think it's really good because we've been really working on it. Denitris and Linda have been making huge improvements in our complaint process. So I think you'd be interested. So
yeah, I think so. And especially for students, sometimes students don't feel like how does a student fall under the harassment and complaint? And so to have that discussion publicly and have it spelled out for employees, but also for every member that's part of the community of SBCC. So thank you. I know that's going to be a lot of work.
So moving on, 15.1, we've got a 2022-2023 strong workforce update from Dr. Alan Price. I loved all the numbers in this presentation. Lots of info.
Well, good evening, Board of Trustees, Superintendent President Murillo. There's my slides. Before I get started, I'm Alan Price. I'm the Dean of Educational Programs, and I'm the servant over the Health and Human Services and the Technology Divisions. But for the folks that I represent, let me just say right up front, Happy New Year.
Yeah.
We're going to have a great 2023. And I also want to welcome our new trustees, Dr. Gallup, Moore and Trustee Stoddard. It's so good to see you again, Alan. It truly is. Welcome back. I'll try to be brief. I know your time is valuable. I've been asked to give a quick and brief overview of career technical education and a quick snapshot on Strong Workforce, the Strong Workforce program. So this is my fourth time up. I'm going to continue with some of the themes and points that I mentioned in prior presentations. But tonight, what I'll do is provide a quick overview of career technical education. I'll talk about at least a quick demographic snapshot of fall 22, which, if you remember from last year, I provided an eight-year trend line of demographics and class success and awards. So I'll carry up the story from a fall 22 perspective. I'll also mention something new, and that is a few brief moments and comments on our employer or employee outcomes. What are our students doing? How successful are they after they complete their certificate or degree here at Santa Barbara City College? And then I'll just say a few words about some notables that's happened and is happening in this academic year. And then I'll end it with a quick talk on Strong Workforce. Where are we? And what are some of our broad and big picture plans as we move forward? So bear with me. I believe I have the opportunity to control the slides from down here. Let's see if this works. If not, I can just wing it and we'll talk about career tech as we go forward. I know there's supposed to be a slight delay. There we go. So first and foremost, what is career technical education? I mean, in its broadest sense, it really, in my humble opinion, it's focused education. It's education that's typically accomplished in a shorter time frame than a traditional discipline, but it provides the knowledge, skills, and abilities for students to quickly step into a career. Now, here at Santa Barbara City College, it is robust. It is diverse. We account as far as declared majors, the number of majors that students declare themselves into, we're holding about 59% of our student base that have declared CTE as their major. We also see a continuation of their success, and this is measured by their passing through our courses. How successful are they to complete their courses? And what we're seeing, continue to see, and if you recall from last year's presentation, when you look at course success from a non-CTE perspective and course success from a CTE perspective, there are differences. Non-CTE course success typically falls in between 72 to 75%. That's the number of students that successfully pass through their courses. And in CTE, it falls between 77 and 80%. Well, in fall of 22, just this past semester, we were at 81%. So that's a strong indication that we continue to help our students in moving through their courses. And we also, at least in last year, we continue to provide a robust base of awards. And as indicated by the 729 awards that we did award to our students in the 2021-22 year. Now, what is important, and I think is really a differential between CTE and non-CTE, is we are serving our local employers. It's very common to step anywhere in our Santa Barbara community and run into one of our graduates. We are also providing a set of programs that does serve our local community. As a perfect example is within our auto program. We have over 70% of our local students that come into that program. And most importantly, we are, I believe, truly serving an underrepresented student population, as indicated by the following slide. Now, what we're looking at here is the demographic breakdown for CTE, again, fall 2022. But with any data, you know, there really needs to be some asterisks. And I have two asterisks that I have to put up and at least bring forward to you. And the first is There should be an asterisk that's at the bottom of the slide that has inadvertently been cut out. And it is a reference to that this data should be looked at in terms of relative terms and not absolute. The data itself has been formatted, has been rounded using standard rounding rules, but as such, it may provide not a clear picture, and I'll call it out. In our student population basis, we have various groups. Our smallest populations tend to be American, Indian, Alaskan Native, Asian, Black, and African American, Pacific Islanders. As the data is shown here, it shows a zero. And that is not actually correct. And what the data should have been shown, and I'll say up front, and my apology, if I had an opportunity to reformat this, I would be that anything that has a zero really should be a less than 1%. I would hate to have anyone who's tuning in tonight or sitting here today to look and say, oh, Santa Barbara City College has no Pacific Islanders. It's just a very, very small population. So that's the first point that I want to mention. And the second point, the second asterisk, is I'll make some broad indicator statements tonight for CT as a whole, as a collective. Now, those statements, that story may change as we start to drill into the individual programs. So, for example, one of the things that we see in CTE is CTE in general serves a larger number of female students than non-CTE. But then when you step into the individual programs, that changes. Programs like early childhood education, cosmetology, nursing, that tends to be primarily female. If you look at programs like automotive technology, construction technology, marine diving, those tend to be more male. So that is a second point, that as you drill down into the individual programs, you often get a different story. But what we can also see in the data is CTE as a whole is truly, and I believe, serving that underrepresented population. We can look at our first generation students. There is a 11% difference between non-CTE and CTE. If you look at the makeup of the actual ethnicities or races, we see some differences as well. Our two biggest groups are white and Latino, Latina, and Hispanic. And out of that, a larger percentage is pursuing from the Hispanic group into our career technical education. Now, if we look at one particular program in general, and that's our biggest program with respect to career technical education, that's our business administration. What we're looking at there is a more equal representation of male and female. What we're also seeing is a larger number of white students in that program. When we drill further and start looking at the next tier of programs, the next slide, which should come up in a minute, and I recognize there's often a delay. There we go. We see a different story. For our smallest populations, Black, African American, and Asian, what we're seeing is those students are typically, not always, but typically showing more interest in our health information technologies and our finance accounting pathways as far as the certificates and degrees. There is a difference in the Latino, Latina, and Hispanic populations and the whites as well. As a whole, if I had to make broad statements in terms of our white population of students, I would say this. I would say they tend to gravitate towards a business pathway or what, as a collective, I would say the creative programs. That is our film and TV production, media arts, and design and photography. That said, we are seeing a larger representation of that group in our environmental horticulture and our drafting CAD interior design. On the Latino, Latina, and Hispanic populations, we tend to see them coming in and showing more interest in our automotive services, cosmetology, radiography technology, administration of justice, and early childhood education. We know who our students are. We are tracking their success as far as their progression through their coursework. A very good and fair question to ask is, what are they doing after they graduate? And I'll be honest with you, if you were to ask me this question today versus 8 years ago, I would have two different answers. 8 years ago, I would probably have said, I don't know. We have some general senses of what's being reported back through our department chairs. But today we are much, much closer to having a better sense, a better understanding of the successes from a past post-graduation point of view than we've ever been. And one of the things that I feel is very strong and very smart of City College is about 3 years ago, we hired through Strong Workforce, a CTE institutional researcher. And one of the tasks that she stepped into, and I believe it makes us unique to other community colleges in our region, is we survey all, or we attempt to survey all CTE graduates 6 to 8 months after graduation. We ask them questions. What are you doing? Where are you working? How long did it take you to get that job? And what is your salary? And from that, we can extrapolate a sense of the success of our students from an employment perspective. Now, looking at the data that I pulled for this presentation, recognizing that we've had 9 semesters to sample, and I'm showing 6. For transparency, the first 2 semesters I did not include in this view, and the reason I did that is that was our learning phase. We made changes to the survey instrument, and I didn't want to sway or cloud the data for tonight. And then our most recent fall 2021 data, we just received that back, and we're in the process of calling through the data, and it was not available at the time for this presentation as far as the data point of view itself. But nevertheless, what we can see is for a period of fall 18 to fall 20 to spring 21, which constitutes about 533 respondents. And in that time, we're looking at about a 23 to 31 in this case. Our average is about 26% as far as the response rate. What we can see is 64% of our graduates from this surveys, from the sample population, are employed, and they're employed within their field of study. We also can say that we have a percentage of those students who proceed on in further education. In sample period in the population that we looked at, we're looking at about 23% of those students reporting back to us that they're continuing on for a 4-year degree. And we also have found, at least with the data, that the average wage change from the time they start to the time they graduate and step into employment went from $16 to $27. And this is comparison to today's number of a livable wage. Livable wage is measured for this case, a single adult and 0 children. Obviously, if you have a family, you have children, a livable wage will definitely increase. So what we've seen is a positive change there. That said, this is an average, and I have to call out when we drill down in individual programs, we're seeing much, much greater success in terms of a wage gain change. Programs like nursing, obviously, we have students that are leaving and stepping into a $90,000 career, $45, $50 an hour. We're seeing that same pattern in radiography. We're also starting to see changes even in the lower tiers, emergency medical technician, which a couple of years ago I reported those graduates tended to come in around minimum wage or maybe a couple bucks more. Now what we're seeing, depending on how they do their shift differential, closer to the $20, $23 range, depending, as well as programs like CNA. Prior to COVID, typically a couple bucks above minimum wage. Today we're seeing, and it's not uncommon to find CNA graduates that are starting at $19, $20 and moving up to $21, $24 an hour. I'm very proud of CTE. I know we're doing some great stuff, and unfortunately, I don't have the time to report everything that we're doing, but I do want to call out a few notables, and these are not inclusive of everything that we do. As an example, one thing, if you saw it in today's email, an announcement of a relationship of a partnership that we've established with Santa Barbara County. This is to establish an internship pathways through 22 of their departments. That's big. But in addition, we have done some amazing work over the last year, and we're going to have some work coming up in spring. First and foremost is the work that we're doing in TK. SB 876, that should be 876, by the way, not 873. what that did, that happened in 2015. That called out that for folks to work in transitional kindergarten or TK, they had to accumulate 24 credits of early childhood education. This has to be met by this upcoming summer. Well, our ECE department has been working tirelessly. And what we've done is we partnered with First Five. We've set up those 24 credits. It can be obtained through our standard certificate for early childhood education. But most importantly, we've gone back and we've revamped our scheduling to ensure, recognizing that TK folks are working adults. They have a job. They cannot come to campus during a typical day period. So all the classes that are needed for TK can be accomplished either in the evening or online. We also established a four training program. This was done in partnership with Perry Ford. This was done last semester. And this is very exciting. What this does is it gives us access to their training modules that we bring back into our curriculum, but we also are now set up to allow and support paid internships through Ford. We have been approached over the Christmas break, and this is one of the things that we're going to be pursuing coming up in this semester, is looking at a relationship with Honda through their PAC program. This is similar to the Ford program, as well as setting up an internship opportunity through Tesla's tech internship program. This is very exciting. This will allow students to work at a Tesla service center paid, whether it's full-time or part-time, and Tesla will work with the students to accommodate their school schedule. So this will allow for the students that are able to get into it an opportunity to work as well as to be paid. One of the things that I'm very excited about, its potential for Santa Barbara City College. And I do want to say thank you to the Board of Trustees and your vote in supporting this position. The Director of Employer Engagement is ongoing. We're in the hiring phase right now. We're anticipating having that position in place by early April. But this position is set up to help us as a college become more forward-facing out to our industry partners. This is a position that the person responsible will be developing those relationships with our industry base. They'll be identifying those job opportunities and internship opportunities and bringing it back to the college that the support team through our career services and others will be able to help facilitate move students through to find employment. But this person will also help us to identify those changing training opportunities and those changing program opportunities that we haven't had a chance to explore or even to know about. This position and this person will help us to do that. And that could obviously be at the non-credit side, but also at the credit side as well. I do have to call out, we are seeing some changes in the leadership in CT, and primarily in my side. We just hired our full-time faculty in construction technology after a three-year absence. So Timmy Palmer, that's right. It's very exciting. And what he's going to be doing this coming year is working on the revamp of our construction technology program. We are currently working on revamping some of our curriculum. For example, in cosmetology, the state of California has changed the licensing requirements. A cosmetologist required 1,600 hours of training to obtain their license. That now has since been moved to 1,000 hours. And they've also introduced a new opportunity for a hairstylist certificate of 600 hours. What we're doing through cosmetology is revamping our program to align to those, and that is anticipated to be done this semester. Not the end. We also have made some big changes in our automotive technologies program. What we're doing in career technologies first started with culinary arts. Now it's moving into automotive technology, is looking at stackable certificates. The idea, you have short certificates that build upon each other to agree. And what automotive technologies has done, and they're in the process of finalizing it with a hope that we'll have it in place by next fall, is they've created a basic automotive technician certificate of about 17.5 credits that will feed into a second pathway that ends at about 42-ish credits for a certificate in automotive technology and services. And then, of course, if you add 18 to 20 plus credits on top of that, we give a pathway for students that do want their associate's degree. But why this is powerful is we're trying to capture and provide an opportunity for those students who need to quickly get out into the workforce. They don't have that time to step into a 40 plus credit program. We're looking at those shorter pathways, but I think it sets us up for other opportunities. And the idea of a basic certificate, for example, 1745 credits, has been presented to our dual enrollment partner. We have a single automotive technology dual enrollment program in Santa Barbara County, at Santa Barbara proper. And we presented at least the basic talk, and we'd like to continue on with that conversation. But what we might be able to set up and to see with their support, of course, is to look at a dual enrollment program that is structured such that a high school student can complete their diploma plus a basic certificate that will allow them to immediately step into a career upon graduation, as well as to have a bridge into our credit program for more training and on for a degree. So very exciting stuff. And these are the things that has happened and will continue to happen as we move forward for this academic year. As an administrator, it's easy for me to talk about projects. It's easy for me to talk about budgets, but we cannot forget that it's the faculty, it's our amazing faculty and staff that are working in the front lines that's truly changing lives. And I had to share this quote with you. This came from an anonymous auto student, actually from San Marcos, that I think really exemplifies all the things that we're doing so right at City College. And this student said, "I only joined the auto class because the majority of the school told me the teacher was cool." First, I was impressed that he said cool. I thought cool was an outdated term, like radical and groovy, but he said cool. But what's more important is he said, "Now I have found an interest in something for my future." And I think that is so powerful. And it just, to me, resonates that the work that the faculty are doing, the support that they're getting from our classified team members, as well as the college as a whole, is really helping students to find their pathway and to help them to move through successfully. And they did say there would be a 3-second delay. And of course, I hit it twice. Let's see if I can get back. There we go. Everything that we've accomplished in career technical education for the last 7 or 8 years, I believe, has been possible, not solely, but heavily, with the support that we receive from Strong Workforce. As mentioned in prior presentations, Strong Workforce is a legislatively driven funding that comes from the state to the colleges. It's broken up into two streams, a local stream, which serves and is supported at the local level, and a regional stream, which is local driven, but the work that's done has to support a broader scope in our case, a region. And I've also mentioned that it tends to have varying timelines as to when it needs to be expended. We've already closed out the first 5 years. We're in the process of closing out the sixth year, and we've just established work and plans for the seventh year. In that, we've done some major work, and it continues to be our focus of improving our instructional learning spaces. We've already updated our main culinary teaching kitchen, and thank you for those that had the opportunity to come and visit that last year. We have made changes and upgrades to our nursing lab, to our Orfila Early Learning Child Care Center, marine diving, and the list goes on. And we're going to continue that as we move forward for this year. We're going to continue in a phase two project to upgrade our DAC lab. We're making the finalizations for our journalism space. We have just finished work in our computer network engineering program. I should know that. I managed that for several years. And that is going to be available this semester, as well as the work that are going to have completed. Students are going to be stepping into a new space for the drafting and CAD and interior design programs coming up January 30th, the end of this month. That is on top of the work, and Martha and her team has been amazing. And thank you again for your support with the funding for CTE marketing. That's going to be ramping up, and that is an 18-month project. And I have high hopes that's going to have a positive impact for our programs as well. we are continuing forward for this upcoming year with that improvement position and that improvement plan. We're going to be expanding work in our allied health nursing lab. We're going to do an upgrade of our mannequins, both at the bedside, but also at the simulation level. We are going to continue on building out our second and tertiary kitchens that support our culinary program. And we are going to obviously continue on with developing new programs and new opportunities. I do have to call out, last year, I said we were going to be working on a medical academy for non-credit. Well, I will blame COVID, and I think COVID is a good excuse, but it is true. We've had some impact because of COVID in the operations. So that plan is now going to be done and moved into an analysis phase for this year. But that is ongoing, and that has a lot of potential for some positive benefit for the college. All this is, of course, continuation with the four positions that I mentioned last year. They will continue on for this year. And those positions are there to support our programs, whether it's at the curriculum side, whether it's in the nursing lab, but also in the research side and through our career services with our internship and job placement specialist. I want to say, and I think I said this last year, I'm very excited of what we've accomplished, but I'm more excited of where I think we're going. And where we are today is definitely going to be different than where we are tomorrow. And I think tomorrow's going to be better. We've got a lot of the things in place that I think is going to start generating fruit down the way. But I have to also say that everything that we've accomplished has not been easy. It's been a challenge these last couple of years working under COVID. Many of our plans that we've put in place and we've tried to implement have been delayed. We finished a number of them, but they've been delayed. And often it's the product that we need is not available, or the timeline to receive it is now a 3-month, a 6-month kind of a thing. It's the changes in the construction cost as a result of the opening up of the economies. But nevertheless, we move forward. And I think the work that we've done couldn't have been accomplished without your support. Again, thank you. But also from the tireless dedication of so many on campus, from the faculty that work in the front lines, as well as all the back-end folks that are here day in, day out to keep us going forward. So with that, thank you. Thank you. And I would love to answer any questions if you have any at this time.
Thank you. Do we have questions? Trustee Gallardo.
I have more of it. First, I want to say thank you, Alan, for your leadership and your stability. And as long as I've been on this board, you've just been a very solid, stable leader. And everybody knows I'm a fan of athletics, but this is my favorite department. this is the department that is getting our city moving. And the people that come out of this department are the people that I need every single day. Besides my doctor, it's the person drawing my blood, taking my medical bills, fixing my car, and the amazing team that you need when you're going under construction. So I am just super impressed that the transitional kindergarten support, I mean, I remember talking about that forever ago. The fact that Tesla, that's getting underway. I remember when you and Lori had that tour, maybe in 2012, I think. I mean, that was like a real long time ago, to see Honda on there. I know I had emailed Maria. So this is definitely, you can see a lot of work that went into this, and CT is the backbone of the upward mobility. And when I see these guys in the trades, they need their contractor's license, and that's what's going to get them ahead. And so to see another parent and another guy say, I got my license. And so whatever we can do to support you and to support this department, because to me, CTE in Santa Barbara is what's going to elevate our, especially our Hispanic Latino communities who work in a lot of these trades. And boy, I'll tell you, these men, I mean, they're artists. If you see the way they lay tile and the way these bathrooms and kitchen, it is amazing. And every time I come in contact with one of them, I want to know what we can do. And so I think you hit a lot of that when you mentioned the transitional kindergarten model, getting these guys the classes when they're not on the job site. And sometimes it is going to be on a weekend or on a Sunday afternoon, and these guys are out there. So the fact that you're already thinking of that, I really want to see that same transitional kindergarten model go into the community. But just all around, thank you for making this have a vision that is going to just propel and blow everybody out of the water because Santa Barbara is ready.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Trustee Gallardo. And I want to say, and I know Martha will be leaving us, but maybe someone on her team, I think you would be such an excellent spokesperson and someone to interview because everything you said was spot on and very well said, by the way, too. Thank you.
Thank you. Trustee Gallardo.
You definitely have my interest with this department, with the information that you provided. I do have a question. Have you started tracking the completion rate of students since the implementation of some of these internships? Do you have that kind of data?
You know, that's a very good question. And I would, my answer is yes, but. So here's the but part. We have not officially tracked internship opportunities. The number, let's start from the beginning. The number of new internship companies identified, the number of internships available, whether they're paid or unpaid. We haven't done that until this academic year. With the new director of employer engagement that's coming in and the alignment within the region, those tracking mechanisms college-wide, region-wide, statewide hasn't existed. But we now are being required to do that on a quarterly basis. So if you were to ask me what those numbers are, I have them, but I will be upfront and honest that we've only done it for one quarter. Mm-hmm. So the view is very fuzzy. But next year, I'd be happy to come in and provide a little bit more information, who the companies are, mm-hmm. how the change has happened. Are we seeing more and more growth? The internship opportunities, are they paid? Are they unpaid? Those kind of things as we move forward.
Okay. So again, your report has sparked a huge interest in me. I have a couple pages of questions that we could talk offline.
Love
to. I get to know the significance of what your department is doing and hiring that person to increase and improve that community partnership for more collaboration. I think that's spot on for what this institution needs because there's a lot of low-hanging fruit out there. And if we're talking about increasing student enrollment, this is what you need to do. You need to be able to provide jobs,
yes,
a precursor to what that looks like as an adult with a living wage. So yes, I will definitely be reaching out to your department for more information.
I would love that. And I do want to also call out Carla Smith and the fantastic work and the potential that School of Extended Learning represents for us. You know, we typically think of enrollments as that standard 18 to 24 year old, but we're seeing changes. We're seeing a greater opportunity from that 24 to 44 year range, looking for career transitions. So what they want, what they need is different than someone right out of high school who can commit to a full-time study in a traditional day type programs. And that's why I'm so excited. And I know we have the right leader with Corolla in place to start exploring that with support of this director of employer engagement as we move forward.
Thank you. Any other questions, Trustee Croninger?
Well, I completely agree with Veronica's comments and Charlotte's comments. I mean, this is a wonderful program. It's really great to hear about it every time. A couple of questions. One is, I think that you have somebody who is at least part-time counseling, and it strikes me that this is something that is very helpful for students coming into, you know, they may have the idea of this kind of program, but clearly there are differentials in what kind of a job mm-hmm. and salary you get coming out of it. Mm-hmm. And so having that intake counseling strikes me as really important to help students distinguish, you know, it's not necessary. They might be interested in multiple things, but not know that one is pretty low paid and another is really a career opportunity long term. So I hope we've do as much as we can on that. In the internship area, I have noticed that Amazon makes a big deal about what they do in terms of supporting employee education. So I'm wondering about whether we might reach out to them as well as you know, a partnership
yep.
where we could work with them.
I think they're very good points. And thank you. Thank you for both. I do, for full transparency, have to say a few words on the part-time counselor. That is for non-credit. On the credit side, we have a robust group of folks that work front end with our students, but that is under the leadership of Carla, and I know she's working to set that up as more of a permanent basis, but this is a person there that will support their needs as a board. So thank you for bringing that
up. Yeah, with guided pathways and with this, I just feel like we have come a long way toward helping students understand that it's not just what subject do you like, but it's where you wind up at the end with your career and your job and or career change.
Or the career change, that's right.
And so I just think that's really
it is important.
Important.
Thank you.
Trustee Miller.
Thank you for that great presentation. I just have a comment that I'm constantly asking, primarily it's young people, when I'm at the doctor, when I'm getting my hair cut, when I'm at the auto shop, how'd you get the job and where'd you go to school? Where'd you get educated? Mm-hmm. 9 times out of 10 at Santa Barbara City College. Mm-hmm. What'd you think of Santa Barbara City College? Did it serve you well? I'd never hear a negative response, not once. So I think those are, that's my sample of the rating that we get in this community.
I think
so. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I hear the same. I'll just echo the support from everybody and just one shout out to your partnership with the county. I know the person who got that internship started, and I let them know that now it's a major partnership with all departments and City College involved. So that's
very exciting.
Yeah.
Very exciting. Thank you very much. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Trustee Wood, I'm going to excuse myself. I would have excused myself at 6:30, but I needed to hear Ellen's presentation. My daughter's going back to college, and I will be joining a late family dinner that has been underway, so I have to go.
No problem.
Thank you. I'll see you guys next time.
We're going to move to 15.3 SBCC Accreditation Follow-Up Report, March 2023.
I will make this as quick as possible. Trustee Gullett-Moore asked me today if she asked really good questions, and her question gets to the heart of this report. So she sent a note and asked a question about, give me an example of what this really meant. So this is a follow-up report to our accreditation visit, our comprehensive. We had an 18-month report due after our accreditation visit. And we did have one finding that was compliance. And if an accreditation recommendation is a compliance issue, you need to resolve it within 2 years of the time that it is acknowledged. So I would like to acknowledge Denitris Lewis, who worked on this. And I believe Melanie Eckert-Prosser was also involved in helping work on this report. And Dr. Z. Reese, who is also our ALA and who I'm standing in for tonight. To resolve the issue around the fact that we were not following one of our procedures regarding the evaluation of managers. Mm-hmm. And so that has been resolved. And so that was the answer I gave Trustee Gullett-Moore today was, here's the example. This was the item, and we were not following it for the manager's evaluations. And thanks to all the good work in HR, we are now in compliance. And so we are hopeful that the commission will accept our report and we can move forward with affirmed accreditation without any additional reports. The next report we would have due would be the midterm, and then on to our comprehensive in 4 more years. So
any questions or comments on this? All right, thank you for the update and getting this resolved.
We need a motion to
is an action
let's
item
an action. Let's anyone have a motion?
I'll move to approve.
To approve, do a
second.
See Croninger. And let's take a vote. Everyone voting yes, vote yes.
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 Everyone voting no. Anyone abstaining? All right, motion passes. Next up is a monthly budget update for December 31st.
So we went over this last night in the finance and budget or the audit work group. And Brian and I are here to answer any questions if you have any regarding this report.
Anyone have questions? All right, no.
Thank you. Things are not a lot of changes. Thank you. Next is the January governor's budget update 23-24.
We will ask Vice President Bonstock to please give us an overview.
Hi, good evening. Thank you for having me as your interim.
Thank you for coming.
So I have, I'll try to make this as brief as possible too. Let's see, how do I open up the PowerPoint?
It should usually goes automatically.
Yes, they have it. Oh, he's working on it probably.
Make a quick statement while we're waiting.
Yes, Trustee.
Here we go.
Never mind. There it is. I'll do it later.
Great. Well, thank you. The governor came out with his proposed budget last week, and there's been a flurry of analysis and all on it. And overall,
there's a delay on it.
There we go. Yeah, so there are some negative parts to the budget, but thankfully very little as it relates to higher education, especially community colleges. And these are some of the concerns that were highlighted. Obviously, inflation is a big one. Income tax, as you know, California relies quite heavily on a very few very wealthy people for a large amount of our personal income tax, and capital gains is what drives that. And obviously that's not been occurring at the level it had been. And so we took a pretty big hit in that. Did I get the first slide? Oh, here we go. Overall, the budget is down 3%, but again, not for us. We did very well in it. And the Prop 98 augmentation here, we have it as $778 million, and that manifests in a number of ways. One of them is a sizable COLA. In all my years in government, I've never seen an 8.13% COLA. Now, keep in mind, all of this is a proposal, and it's very early in the season. It's January, and this will ultimately be approved in June. It's near the end of June, actually. So there's a lot to happen between now and then. But for community colleges, as several people have noted earlier tonight, 8% COLA is quite nice. We didn't get it any in our base. Generally, we do have the opportunity to grow. And I have to say that's one of the emphasis of the governor's budget for higher ed for community colleges was to grow enrollment. And they make that point several times. There is one negative aspect as it relates to us, and that is this year, not in this budget year, but in the current year, we were given around $10.4 million in schedule maintenance money and instructional equipment. And that's, in my experience, a pretty high number for those two categories, which is wonderful, but that's in our budget today. And part of next year's budget is to take some of that money away this year. So while we have put it in our budget, and it could be as much as 25%, because the governor wants to encourage student enrollment and retention. So the $200 million that he's putting towards that effort is coming from our schedule maintenance and instructional equipment budget this year. So we're going to be very careful about committing those funds until we have a better idea about this. That's really the only downside to the budget, I think. Again, it's very early, and a lot of people have a lot to say about that. That's the main thing. It's the budget was based off the governor's roadmap for the future, which came out last year, and you all probably are more familiar with that than I am, but it has very ambitious goals. 70% of working age Californians having a college degree, but growing enrollment, increasing the equity. Those are all things that are outlined in the budget in several places. Let's see. Here we go. So how does it affect us specifically? And again, keep in mind that these are very early numbers, but overall we could get as much as $8.3 million increase in this before our opportunity to grow. And you can see the $2.3 million for the enrollment incentives comes at the cost of our this year's scheduled maintenance. So, and we know we have a lot of the deferred maintenance and, you know, institutional equipment needs. So, but that's really it. Again, it's very early in the season, but so far we're starting out very well. So if you have any questions, if I can answer them.
Any questions? Oh, Trustee Ed.
Thank you very much. And I don't have a question as much as just a comment. One of the things that I did want to say, in addition to the fact that our budget really looks good for us considering, the governor did say that even though we are in a much better place because of the emphasis placed on the community colleges, and that's where our values are, that we do still need to keep an eye on our budgets as individual districts, because we don't know what the May revise is going to look like. And, you know, there's still a little bit of flexibility there. So even as we're excited and, you know, feeling good about where we are, we still have to be mindful, as you were saying. So I just wanted to emphasize that, because they did say for those of us to really keep our eye on the district's funds, because mm-hmm. it can change.
Great. Thank you.
Trustee Croninger.
Yeah, so I would totally agree with what Anna just said. And looking at the bigger economic picture, we hear a lot about, you know, many people feeling we're going to have a recession this year. What will that mean in terms of our potential cutback the possible fight over the debt limit could really make the stock market much worse, which is, as Brian said, capital gains is where California gets a lot of its overall income.
Any other questions? All right, thank you
for thank the you.
Update. Next up, there are 29 hours left to apply for the superintendent president position, and we're gonna turn it over to our committee co-chair, Trustee Everett, for an update.
Well, actually there isn't anything to report as yet, because the deadline has not come, and we don't have our screening committee meetings for at least a week or so. So we're on track as far as I know, and looking forward to the process and to those files coming in. And we look forward to having something to report.
Hoping you have a busy time with so many applications. Yes, Trustee Miller.
Can I just add, the deadline is tomorrow at midnight. So, and then I think the committee—
I lost a week.
I think the committee will have the opportunity to start reviewing the application sometime next week. It goes through HR first for an initial screen.
Do we have a sense of the size of the applicant pool?
Not yet. But unless, Vice President, do you have any?
Yesterday, 19 candidates. Okay. I'm sure more will come in on the last day, yeah. As always. All right. Any other questions, comments on our search? I'm sure we'll hear a lot more at the next couple of meetings. It'll really ramp up after tomorrow. Okay. So next is report from board members. Does anybody have any reports? Trustee Stoddard.
Next week, I'll be going to Sacramento for a training and for the conference, the league conference. Is anybody else going?
I'll be there.
Oh, good. Okay. You'll be there too? Okay.
Great. Does anybody have any other reports? Trustee Miller?
I just say on Sunday, I'm attending an all-day retreat with the foundation.
Great.
Okay.
Anything else? Okay. Awesome. Next we have, student trustee Rajosera. Sorry about that.
Okay. Happy New Year, everyone. Since our last board meeting, I've been working with other members of DSG on improving our makerspace at SBCC. We worked on marketing strategies we are going to use this semester, as well as workshops we put in place to make the makerspace accessible to any students from any major. And the SBCC Olympics Project 2 will happen this semester. And we are organizing that. And it's very exciting. We sent out a survey to students a few days ago, asked the club leaders to spread the word. And students are very receptive. And concerning the prayer, meditation, and relaxation room, the room we will use has been cleaned out and everything sometime during the first weeks of January. So next week, we'll start putting the material there and we will keep you updated on the opening ceremony date.
Thank you. Looking forward to that for sure. We'll move on now to agenda item 16.3, discussion on resolution 12, limiting campaign contributions. Thank you, Trustee Gallup-Moore, for bringing this for discussion. It is timely. We do have now majority of the board has gone through the election process with these rules, and there have been some changes at the state level in regards to campaign contribution limits. When we passed this, there were no limits. You can donate $100,000 to someone's trustee race. Now there's a limit of $4,900. At the state level. So it's good to just review the work we've done in the past. So Trustee Gallup-Moore, do you want to open this item?
Yeah, so I would like to say the idea of having the campaign limitation amount, it's a good idea. As we know, in certain arenas, running for office has become very polarized. And now it's impeding upon educational type campaigns across the board. However, the limitation that was recommended in this resolution, it's not equitable and it's not feasible. And it actually creates and perpetuates the barrier for allowing everyone to be able to run in a campaign and be somewhat successful. It's not ideal. It actually promotes only those of a certain socioeconomic level that can self-fund their campaign and run for these types of roles. And therefore, that impedes on the ability of having a diversified collective of representatives of our community at large. So I made a recommendation at this place on our agenda, and I would strongly like to encourage my fellow trustees to consider adjusting the campaign limitation amount.
Thank you, Trustee Miller.
And I assume when you talk about that, you're saying that I think our limit is $200. Yes. You think that limit is too low?
It's extreme. It's not realistic.
What do you think it should be?
I would say to increase it to $1,000.
I would agree with that.
Any other discussion? Trustee Croninger, you brought forward this resolution originally.
Yeah, I brought it forth originally because it was a difficult situation in a different way. And not the last time I ran, but the time before that, the amounts that were being raised were in the neighborhood of $40,000, $45,000. Not by me, but another candidate. And that seemed to me to be really an amount that is too much for a trustee race, and also an amount that was not achievable for an ordinary person. Now, I recognize there's this problem, and it really has more to do with the current campaign finance law, because ideally we would say self-funding is at a similar limitation, whatever that is, whatever that number is, but we couldn't. So that's where we came up with the idea of a significantly lower limit than even the 4,900. As you said, it was even much higher. You can quickly be overwhelmed by someone with the right contacts as opposed to someone with, you know, self-funding. And so there, in certain sense, there's no good answer. But I do think this worked as intended in terms of who is on the board, that you raised money from a broad group of people. And that was the intention, is really to involve as many people in the community, your district, as possible. So that for that reason, I think it works. I can see raising the number somewhat. I think 1,000 is pretty high. You know, it's a rich person's contribution, shall we say. And I feel that, as you mentioned, political polarization is also a problem. And so we tried to do what we could, frankly, and there are limitations to what you can do with this.
Trustee Stoddard.
Are we not allowed to put a limit on what a person can give to themselves? We're not allowed to.
No, the state law won't let us.
If I could.
Yes. Citizens.
Trustee Miller.
It's my view, and I said this when this came up the first, when we passed this, when the board passed this resolution, that I think the, first of all, that the $200 limit is not consistent with what court rulings have been at the higher levels, the Supreme Court and Court of Appeals. And so I think the $200 is most likely, if it was ever challenged, is unconstitutional. Secondly, I think I'd welcome even a higher number than 1,000. I think it's, the point is, I think it's difficult to raise $40,000 if that's what it's needed to compete with your opponent. It's hard to do that when you're limited to $200 increments. And that's just the reality. So I think, in fact, having the lower limit you have is really kind of an incumbent protection limit, because as an incumbent, you have certain inherent advantages. And for somebody to want to challenge you as an incumbent, they need to raise a good amount of money. And it's harder to do that with $200 limits.
Okay. Trustee Goldmore, and then back to Trustee Croninger.
I'm happy to provide a report for the next meeting just to give you an itemization of what a typical campaign will cost you. Just to file your paperwork and make a statement is over $1,000. And so I need over five people to give me $200. And that actually costs me more money, because if I want to do things above board and have a treasurer, because I don't know anything about FPPC filing and all that stuff, I have to pay my treasurer to take care of all those individual donations. So the $200 is not realistic. Your objective here, I support. I wholeheartedly support it. Maybe your race, that particular race, was an outlier. That particular person may have been well known and from a monetary standpoint, well supported, but this doesn't make it an equitable way for allowing a diverse community to come and think about running and being a voice when you put these types of unrealistic limits. So please take into consideration the costs to just put your name out there. As we all know, Santa Barbara County has only 2% African Americans. And so for me to really extend myself, and it's really not about me, you can look at the data. Data will tell you, having limitations like this, it doesn't benefit an equitable playing field for both the person who never ran before and then the person who's not well known. And so you need to be able to raise enough funds to even have a substantial campaign without hiring a staff. So I extremely encourage that we consider this limitation and increase it to $1,000. I don't believe that is an unreasonable ask.
Thank you. Okay. Trustee Croninger.
Okay, first off, I know Robert has his view on constitutionality. We hired a specialist attorney in the area to advise us before we wrote this up. So I feel like, you know, we all have our own legal opinions when we've been lawyers, but we did do the right process there. And no, the point was it shouldn't be $40,000 to necessary to run a campaign. And I'm pretty familiar with what it costs, just having, you know, been through the process and having done it before. In my view, there are basic costs which have to do with the filing fees, the fundraise, the reporting your donations, you know, accounting and reporting for your donations. And I think it would be helpful to have those laid out. But then there's the question of how do you approach the campaign? And in my own experience with that, I think the critical, essential approach is free. And that is you go door to door and talk to people in your district. And we have districts of a size that you can do that.
I campaigned in all three of my districts.
Yeah.
I knocked on over 500 doors.
Yeah. But see, I think that's what really works. I think this, you know, oh, I've got to do TV or I've got to do radio or I've got to do literature and mailings and all of that stuff. I frankly don't think that works to the way as successfully as talking to your constituents and finding out what they know and think about the college and having that interaction. And yeah, you won't reach all of them. They're not all home, but you will reach a lot. So I would say, sure, bring it forward. And I'm certainly open to raising the amount, but I'm still hopeful that we would have a goal that 40,000 is too much to be spending on this. It's better spent on something else than elections. You know, give it to the foundation. And, you know, think about how we can get, and that's one of the reasons we had a, you know, the college will have a forum. Let's get the candidates out there so people can know them. But unfortunately, in this last go round, all the candidates were not interested in the forum. So that's a problem. But that's what happened to it this year.
Trustee Collins.
I just, for the last comment about the candidates were not interested in a forum, I would have to disagree because I was open to any and every forum that came my
I don't think she means you.
Oh, okay.
I didn't mean you. I did not mean you.
and then you keep mentioning $40,000. I'm not mentioning $40,000. I'm mentioning the limit. Can we raise the limit from $200 to $1,000?
Right. I hear that.
Yeah.
And I'm open to that discussion, and I'm sure everyone else is too. It's not just about me. I'm just trying to explain the context here that when you do it in hopefully increments of smaller amounts, your total is not as much. And frankly, that other money could, as I said, be better spent.
But
go ahead, Trustee.
It's not really up to us to decide how your money is spent, how a candidate spends their money. That every individual candidate, if you want, they want to put it all into advertising, that's their choice. I mean, I agree with the concept of going door to door. And the size of our district makes all the sense in the world. It's also a good exercise.
Yeah.
To meet people one-to-one, I found it to be an enjoyable process. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't mean that every candidate's obligated to do that or anything else. They can spend their money however they want to spend it.
I'll just chime in. You know, I've been a candidate for lots of different elections. And from my experience, I do think $1,000 is the right direction to go in. I heard a rumor, you know, in the last election, there was someone who might have run who was going to self-fund $40,000 to $50,000. And when I heard that, I thought of, you know, whoever might run against them, they need 200 people to give them $200. And I don't want candidates to spend all their time fundraising because it's intimidating when you are going up against a lot of money. You start thinking, I need the money too, and I'm going to spend all my time fundraising instead of speaking to voters. And I think that's, you know, that's obviously the best thing is speaking to voters. We all agree. We all got elected. But I think the 200 just makes the fundraising your focus, and it privileges the people who have the self-funding. So yeah, I've dealt with campaigns where I've had no limit, 4,900 and the 200. And so I think I've seen it all. I think there's a balance between 4,900 and 200. I think 1,000 sounds like a good balance. So yeah, I think it does anybody.
I mean, what we would have to do is bring it back for,
right,
for action. This is discussion.
Yes. I think it's good to have this discussion without an action. Yeah. Sitting ahead of us.
No, it's fine. And, you know, frankly, one question we never asked, and it only just occurred to me, is whether you could say no more than 10 contributions at 1,000, and everything else below that has to be. I don't know. Too complicated. Complicated, but potentially a compromise.
Yes, yeah.
Yes, I recently ran, and as you all know, I wasn't sure about the $200 limit, and I did find it to be somewhat constraining. I do appreciate the intent. I'm also one who, as a result of Citizens United and the just ridiculous amounts of money that it costs to just run for dog catcher, you know, there needs to be some controls on the amount that you can contribute to this spiraling upwards. I do think that an increase in the limit is reasonable, and so I do support an increase. I'm open to a discussion about how much or whatever, but I do think that the 200 is a bit low for right now for these days, and so that's my feeling.
Thank you. And I shared with Trustee Everett when we spoke separately about this, but local examples are Oxnard. The city of Oxnard has a $500 limit, and the county of Ventura for county supervisor has a $700 limit just to the south. I don't believe there's other jurisdictions in Santa Barbara County with their own limits. I think we might be the only one, as far as I know. Maybe the city of San Maria, but I'm not 100% sure.
So how would you like staff to proceed?
I think we could come back at a future meeting, February or March, either one, whatever works. And we could have a draft with a new amount, and maybe it can just be an X for the amount. And then we can decide at that meeting what we would compromise on that number. I didn't really hear a strong consensus yet on any specific numbers, so maybe we just have the up for action with an X, and then we could make that decision as a board next meeting.
Yeah, I would also suggest that we've got pretty much flexibility because there's no election for a couple of years, and so depending on your urgency of your other agenda items, you can move it around.
That's why I'm asking. Thank you.
No, take the time, and I think it's good to do it now instead of in an election year. Last time we did it in an election year, and doing it now just means none of us are really saying we're personally interested in the results of this. So.
We just don't want to drop it for you. We want to make sure it gets done. Okay. So I'll probably try to bring it back in your February with the X blank, and then you can, kind of do some research or whatever you want to do between now and then. And because I don't want to.
Yeah, I was just trying to say, if your agenda is looking really full, you have some flexibility with this one.
Thank you.
Yeah, what you guys just said, just don't lose it and do it now.
Yes, it'll stay forever on our items for future consideration list that we'll be mentioning our new system for. All right, well, great discussion on an important policy. Any other comments from anybody? Okay. This one's about me. The next one, 16.4. So I did want to tell the board, I wanted to put my name forward for a nomination to the California Community College Trustees Board. My main interest in doing this is just the last 8 years I've been very interested in the statewide legislative work around higher education. And so I've been our legislative liaison on our board for 5 or 6 years, and I've gone to all the legislative conferences. So I want to just keep doubling down on that work of advocating for our community colleges at the statewide level. So I'd appreciate a nomination from our board for this. And it's an open seat, so there's not an incumbent for what I'm running for.
So you are asking for the board to agree to recommend or nominate you?
It's required to have your board support to run.
Okay, I see somebody is about to make a motion.
I nominate Jonathan for the open seat.
Thank you. Is that a motion?
I move to nominate.
Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Thank you. Now, do we have any other discussions or questions for me?
Good idea.
Thank you.
Exactly.
Yes, Trustee Gullett-Moore.
As someone new here on the board, can you give just a small synopsis of what this role entails?
Yeah, so there's a California Community Colleges League. That's like the overarching association. And they have two segments, one for chief executive officers and then one for trustees. So they have two separate boards. The trustee board does a lot of policy making, mainly focus around legislative. They do the internal operations of the CCLC, like they review the chief executive officer, they manage the budget. So they do the basics that we do here for the college. But I see it as the main role is legislative action, communication, and helping get the communication from the statewide down to the local level better, and also figuring out how the league can serve us better as well. Like, how can they provide trainings and, you know, resources for the local colleges? And for us, we'd be on the trustee side, and then Kindred would be participating, or, you know, others would be participating on the CEO side.
Thank you.
Jonathan? Yes, Trustee Croninger.
So I'm not entirely sure where this happens, but to the extent you can, I would encourage you to lobby for a base increase as we move toward the final budget.
Yes.
With the legislature. I think there's also a CEO component on that side as well that lobbies.
Yeah, we have a brain trust through the league and the chancellor's office that meets on this, and base is always really critical. So mm-hmm. we'll continue to do so.
I support Trustee Croninger's recommendation about that.
It's a very important issue. So great. Well, we have a motion. Let's take a vote. Everyone voting yes?
Yes.
Yes.
Everyone voting no? And abstentions. All right. Thank you, everybody. I do appreciate it. Next, last is our Resolution 13, authorizing teleconferencing for board meetings. So this is the officially last time that this should be on our agenda. So it's February, allowing for Zoom participation for board members.
So what you're saying is that after this month, we won't be doing Zoom meetings anymore. Everything will be in person.
We would have the option. So we can still keep the Zoom for the public to do public comment. And for board members, there's a new law now in place, AB 2449, that will give reasons to be on Zoom for a board member, but you can only use them two times a year. So if you're sick, you can do it. And if there's a local emergency like we have now, we would be able to do it too. So this is for the COVID provisions, and that's expiring on February 28th. And then after that will be
okay.
The general law.
Okay, good.
Yeah, it takes effect in March. So it's the 28th of February. Just want to make sure that's really clear, because
One more meeting for us.
Yeah, one more meeting that you could still operate the way you were.
Yeah, where everyone's on Zoom and you don't need permission. Like, you could have a fully remote meeting. In the future, if there was a natural disaster, we could also do that, but it would need to have a reason.
Okay, thank you.
All right, do we have a motion to approve this resolution?
So moved.
First, do we have a second?
I'll second.
We have a second, and let's take a vote. Everyone voting yes, vote yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Everyone voting no, abstaining. Great. All right, well, we got through the meeting. Next up is item 17, items for future board consideration. If you go on your agenda, there is the list. This is the list from the last board meeting. So we've got some of these done. We don't have, some of these are coming to future meetings. We have some study sessions that include these. We're going to be managing a Google Doc that has all of these, and it's going to kind of have, you know, a suggested column, an in progress, and a done. So we can know by the end of, you know, a year from now, how many we got done that we wanted to suggest. Mm-hmm. We can keep track of what's in progress, and we can know what the backlog is. So look out for that. But for now, we've got this on here as a list. Mm-hmm. And so does anybody have anything for the future? Trustee Gallimore?
I would like for us to look at increasing access to reproduction health, accessibility here on campus.
Okay, thank you. Any more? Trustee Croninger?
I'd just like to reiterate that I'd like for us to get to the resolution in support of our Jewish students.
Let's work on that together before the next meeting.
I think that would be great to get that one.
And we also have what came up earlier was the report on our outreach and marketing department and all the different things we do. So we'll have a study session probably about that. Anything else for now? You can always email them in to myself or Dr. Murillo, and we'll keep them on the list. All right. And we don't need to reconvene to close session. And so we're going to just adjourn this meeting now. It's 7:25 p.m. And we'll see you next time on February 2nd. I think the next time we'll see each other for our meeting with, I'm forgetting his name right now.
Dr. Wood and Dr. Harris.
Yes, Dr. Wood and Dr. Harris. Great.
Yeah.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Adjourned.
Good meeting. Good meeting.
Sorry about the sideways.
Oh, that's okay.
No, well, that's why I want to read it. It's much easier to read.
It's like,
no, no.